God, the mighty God, the great I am. Masotoro mombe kinamanda yishili mahaya. Hallelujah. You are exalted in the heavens. You are high and lifted up. Your glory fills the heavens and the earth. You are exalted in the heavens. You are high. The great I am. Hallelujah. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Oh, kana man jisara man dera man devero. Hira mandala beki arabo subanayan. Sabra be ala mande musira yo. Siva ma mulaye namo yo silana mukhe. Hallelujah. To you throughout the ages, a love that we can barely begin to even
comprehend. Ah, love that we can barely even begin to consider. Oh Lord, a love that will take eternity to reveal. Father, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you for that which you are, who you are, that you're unchanging in your love. You're unchanging in your holiness. You're unchanging in your righteousness. You're unchanging in your mercy. You're unchanging in your steadfast love. You're unchanging in your grace. Oh God, you're unchanging in your long suffering. Oh Lord, you're unchanging in your glory. Oh Lord, you're unchanging in your forgiveness. Oh God, you're unchanging in all those things that belong to your goodness. Oh God, you're unchanging in your humility. You're unchanging in your lowliness and meekness. You're unchanging, oh God, in all of your ways. Oh Father, you're the one who dwells in the light, which no man has seen, nor on any man can approach unto you. Yet you've brought us so near. Father, we praise you. Father, we glorify you. Father, we bless you. Father, we thank you that you are the God who answers by fire. When your fire falls, it consumes your offering. And Lord, your fire has fallen upon us and upon our lives, and you've consumed our emotions and you've consumed our passions. Oh God, that we may come before you not with our own inspirations. Oh God, not with our own strength and with our own energy. Oh God, but with the fire that comes right out of your throne room, right out of your presence. Father, we bless you and praise you. Lord, that we're able to worship you in spirit and in truth. That we're able to lay hold on you and know you and walk with you. Amazing God. Well, praise the Lord. You know, I was listening to Leonard Ravenhill the other night, and he said, you know, it wasn't that long ago that he actually said it. He said, you know, in the Church of America, you can keep playing, I'll let you know when to stop. He said, in the Church of America, it's, you know, you can have these great churches, 20,000, and 10,000, 20,000. I don't remember exactly what words he particularly used or numbers he particularly used. He said, but if you call to prayer, for people to prayer, and you got a huge mega church, you're fortunate if you got 20, 30 people show up. You know, and it's just so sad. He was talking about how he knew ministers that said, well, you know what? They're going to give one night at least of assembly to making God's house what is supposed to be the house of prayer. And he talked about how the ministers would say, okay, we're going to do Sunday morning, Sunday night. It's going to be singing, worshiping, praising God and preaching. Regular meetings, but on Wednesday night, we're going to do prayer. And he was talking about how that the attendance dropped 90% for the nights of prayer. The reality of it is I don't really blame it on people, and I necessarily... I do believe that the leadership responsible. Let me tell you, and in some respects, the leadership really don't understand. The reason people don't pray and the reason they don't enter into passionate prayer is because they don't understand the demonic powers that are out to stop that. Because if a man or a woman, a boy or a girl, if anybody finds the secret realms of prayer, the prayer where the fire of the Holy Ghost begins to consume you and burn you up like an offering on an altar, there is no way that Satan can stop that. There's no way that he's going to have the power to levy over you that he had before. There's no way he's going to be able to work his devices against you because it's a supernatural realm. People try to understand it with their intellect. Just forget about it. You're not going to understand anything about God with your intellect. I promise you, you do not have the skills. You do not have the training. It would be like saying that we want you to go in. You know, you're just off the street. You basically, all you've done is do gardening and rake lawns. And we want you to go launch a rocket to the moon. Or we want you to come in and we want you to remove the pineal body, you know, out of the cranial cavity and do it through, innervate through the nasal canal. That would pale in understanding the skill set. To understand the dynamics of prayer, you're not going to get it. And you've had wrong models. And it's amazing to me, why is it that everybody goes with the wrong models? I thought, when I first started doing animals, I thought, well, if I put a calm animal out there with all of the nervous animals, they'll all calm down. Doesn't work that way. that makes the calm animal nervous wreck. If I take one nervous, crazy animal and I put them out there with the calm animals, surely all the calm animals will cause the crazy, nervous animal, you know, the wild animal, to calm down. No, opposite effect. It is just it's crazy how that the negative, wrong models in every dimension of life impacts everybody. And it seems like there are very few people in the world that have the ability to resist it. There are very few people. It's like they'll go with the model of now I lay me down to sleep, I pray thee, Lord, my soul to keep. They'll go with that model of prayer. They'll go with these models of prayer that are really, by and large, powerless and ineffective. It's not a fervent prayer by any stretch of the imagination, because that's a red-hot prayer. That's a fiery prayer that only God the Holy Ghost can give you. It's not even, and unfortunately, it's more than likely, because it's not a fiery, fervent, red-hot prayer, it's not the prayer of the righteous either. So it's definitely not the fervent prayer of a righteous man that really accomplishes what God has purposed to us to accomplish. Where you find a place of prayer that all of a sudden it transitions from a place of talking to God, that where now you can actually speak and your request is heard, and just the asking results in it not raining, or it raining, or the mountain moving out of the way, or whatever you ask being done. People, I pray in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth that you'll understand how to break past the demonic hindrances that are hindering you, not the church as a whole, not the nation, you. Because if you can understand it and you can break past all of that nonsense, all that stuff that is opposed to the Word of God, it's the opposite of the Word of God, and it works an effect against you so that the fruits of what God described in the new creation isn't allowed to be displayed through you. And and especially when it comes to relationship with God, I'm going to talk to you about that tonight, relationship with the Lord and the dynamics of that, and how you're going to, you know, we try to say check your brain at the door. That didn't go over very well, because now everybody thinks they're going to be deceived. We try to tell you to quit trying to logically, rationally process through it, because it ain't going to work for you. You're never going to get anywhere with that. And that, there's no realm almost for most people to even connect with that. And so we just start back from the beginning and just say it again, just like Jesus said it. And we'll just keep doing it over, and we'll do it over, and we'll do it over, word for word. And we'll add some words, hallelujah, and we'll go to another level of expressing it, praise God, with greater accuracy, till all of a sudden people go, wow, this is the things of the Spirit. Yeah, it has no human realm to it. It's the things of the Spirit. And, you know, I'm just so thankful for every one of you who are involved in participating with us in this 21-day fast. We're going into the 12th day now. Praise God. We're halfway over. Praise the Lord. Somebody said, could we start off a little bit fewer days? Well, you could have 35 years ago. But, you know, this is where we are right now. And, you know, it doesn't matter to me if you're just missing one meal. Half a meal, no. One meal, you know, hopefully you can do a little bit better than that. You can be seated. I'm going to say this to you. You're never going to really grasp the power of prayer until you go hungry. And I like to put things really raw and real. And of course, I'm talking about fasting. Go ahead and shake that up a little bit more. But at any rate, the bottom line of it is, dear people, God wants to take us to a place that it's impossible for us to go there. We've got to participate with Him. And the participation with Him is a spiritual hungry. And so if you're not hungry, quit eating. You hear me?
Yeah.
If you're not hungry, quit eating. Say, if I'm not hungry, then I need to quit eating. And reality of it is there is an amazing thing that happens, because it's spiritually. It's spiritual. It's not like a Muslim fast. It's not like a Hindu fast, a Jewish fast, or any other kind of fast. When you fast in the name of Jesus Christ, seeking God the Father by the power of the Holy Ghost, it is a supernatural event that begins to work within you the power of prayer. It begins to work within you an ability to talk with God. It's been said by so many people, A.W. Tozer was not a great preacher. And some people even said that he was a boring preacher. But when he started praying, watch out. He had an intimacy with God of prayer. And you know, there's a lot of great writers and people who've done a lot of wonderful things, and a lot of great orators and a lot of great preachers and a lot of great teachers, but that God was able to use in great ways throughout the world to change the dynamics of the church, to, you know, bring the church, as it were, into another dimension of relationship with the Lord. But they were all people of deep prayer. And deep prayer is just where you let the Holy Spirit take over. We want to teach you, and I you know, listen, I'm telling you, I get excited when I hear, especially, you know, yeah, older guys, fine, but especially the younger guys, when I hear them just taking, going heads and shoulders against, above everybody else, just grabbing a hold of the fire and running with it. I mean, this front row just gets me going sometimes. I'm just like, come on, man. You know, just hearing the fiery prayers of the Holy Ghost, you can't make that up. You can't pretend. You'll run out of energy. You don't have enough energy to keep up with what the Holy Ghost will do through you. And especially when you've been fasting for 12 days, you don't have enough energy. And, you know, also, let me just say, and I love to give a countdown. I like to encourage you all. Let's, you know, I'll let you know when the 21 days are up. Case. Some days I wake up and my mind, my ability to think is so crystal clear. It is amazing. You know, I can remember details with just crazy stuff of information that I have not been able to recall for years. You know, start quoting the periodic table kind of thing, you know. And just crazy things. But then other days I just wake up and my brain doesn't work at all. It's like, but it's more powerful than it's ever been. And you start fasting and praying. You start fasting and praying and your life will change. Your life will change. And I really don't believe, I've never seen people step in to these things that God has for us without fasting and praying, without fasting. And so I just encourage you to do it. If you don't know how to do it, start doing it. Maybe in this 21 days, you've not been able to go a day yet. At least go 24 hours without eating any food. You will not die. I promise you, you can go a long time without eating food and you will not die. In fact, it's found to be healthy for your body, believe it or not. Even when you're, you know, like me and you can't sleep and you feel like you're, you know, your muscles are being cannibalized and by your own self. And you get all these things going on. The product of it is beautiful. How many of you are hungry for the things of the Spirit?
Yes. Yes.
Okay, then it's no problem. You'll just do anything, whatever it takes. You do whatever it takes. Hallelujah. And Father is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. He's the greatest Father. Hallelujah. He's the greatest boss. He pays great. I'm telling you right now, He pays better than any human being has ever paid anyone in compensation, in total compensation package. And then also, hallelujah, the wage. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of the living God. Isn't God so good? I love just walking around in His presence. I mean, goodness gracious. And I get to do that all day. I don't have to wait till a particular day, Wednesday night or a Sunday morning, Sunday night. Man, I tell you right now, if I did, I would want every day to be Wednesday. What you have in God, your best, you bring to the meeting. It's true, whether you mean to or not, because everything about our life makes manifest who we are. The things that are coming out of our mouth, the demeanor on our face. People say, oh, you know, I pray better than this when I'm at home. No, you don't. What you really have shows in the context of the meeting. And so you want to let God, the Holy Spirit, develop within you these riches so you can bring the treasures into the house.
Amen.
You know, people have monetized the treasures. The treasures are far richer than anything that has a Ben Franklin or, you know, a George Washington or Abraham Lincoln or whoever, you know. It's far richer than any monetary system, any money known to man. It's the riches of the Spirit of God. It's the riches of His divine expressions. It's the riches of His love. It's the riches of His divine power that can say to the blind, see, to the deaf, hear, that can walk around in joy and peace, that can walk around in glory and honor and majesty, that can walk around in integrity, that those people who do what they say they're going to do. You know, people, some people take real... take real pride in the fact that they always do what they tell man they're going to do. I say, big deal. Do you do what you tell God you're going to do? Because that's far more important. That doing what man tells, what you tell man you're going to do, you know, it has value, but it's really overall meaningless. When you do, because it's, you know, it can have so much hypocrisy and it can have so much falsehood in it, right? It can. You know, it's like, you know, you read in John chapter 2 at the end of the verse, I believe it's like right around verse 23, verse 24, and the scripture says at the Passover, they all believed, many believed because they saw the signs which he did. But it's, the next verse of scripture said, but he didn't believe them. It's true. It's what it says. He had trusted himself in the no man. And literally, the word that is used there is the same word that's used in the preceding verse where it says, and they many believed, and they, but reality of it is, you know, many translations kind of dilute it, but he didn't believe them. You know, that's just the bottom line of it is, people, because there's so much falsehood in men, because he knew what was in men. What is in man is falsehoods. False. That, yeah, I'm trying to be true, but you can't do it. Huh? It's like one of the three Stooges saying, I'm trying to think, but nothing's happening. It's trying to be real and true, but you can't, it doesn't work. Nothing's happening. It can't work. It's the falsehood. God in his mercy brought a remedy to that. I mean, come on, people. Father wants to make you real. Why would you want to remain plastic and pretend? Why would you want to let Satan abuse you all in the name of you getting some little cheap thrill that you feel horrible about after it's done? Why? I mean, come on, let's just get a little bit. You know, smart's nothing. Wise is everything. Are you listening to me? How you can train a monkey to be smart. God wants us to be far more than, you know, on the same basis of monkeys, you know, primates. He's hallelujah, brought us. We are his image and his likeness to begin with, praise the Lord. And then he's brought us spiritually into his image and his likeness. And Father has given us an invitation and empowered us with the ability to quit acting like men. Look at yourself. If you scored yourself on a daily basis, you'd have to let somebody who loves you but will tell you the truth score you. Because you'll play make believe. You know, you'll pretend, I mean, we can cast the bet. You know, that's the reason we have a complaint against others or an accusation against others, because we have so, you know, placed ourselves on such a high pedestal. And it's all fantasy, it's all falsehoods. It's not real at all. Huh? I mean, I had an encounter with the Lord Jesus Christ where I abhorred myself and I saw the glory and the beauty of the light that he wanted to give me, and I said, come on, what an exchange. I'll take your life. You mean I get to end, my life gets to be over? I get to hate my life in this world, hallelujah, and have yours? And you know, that's the encounter. And so somehow a lot of folks seem to be missing out on these things, you know, or the powers of darkness have come in and deceived them and distracted them, and they begin to believe wrong things. But if you know, if you just let somebody score you and just say, listen, how much of my life am I acting like a mere man, and how much of my life am I walking in the Holy Ghost? Am I giving myself over, giving all attendance to making my call and election sure? For me, what Peter said there is exactly the same thing that Paul said when he said, lay hold on eternal life, or take a firm grip on eternal life, or when he said, as you said to the deacons, let no man take your crown from you. Of course, reality of it is, dear people, everybody has a ministry opportunity, and there is a crown with that ministry opportunity, and that ministry opportunity can be neglected and that crown taken from you. And so, you know, it's like one preacher said, you know, it's going to be a terrible thing when people have to walk around throughout the ages and see their crown on somebody else's head. You know, that's a good way of saying it. I mean, hey, try to motivate folks, you know. Let no man take your crown from you. Give all diligence to make your calling and election sure. What Papa's got given to us is not something cheap. It's not something just one of the other options. My goodness, he's brought us into the high life. He's given to us his life. He's given to us the greatest opportunities that we could possibly ever have. Father, he's so amazing. Our speaker system, it has this weird thing going on. The volume goes way, way down. The volume comes way, way up. We try to get one speaker, one microphone up, and the one third, three down from us is going up, and ours is going down. So we always have a bit challenged here with get one microphone is feeding back, the other one isn't working. So you just have to hang with us. Hallelujah. As we try to figure out what wire went where. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, mighty God. Kiste kim brondangeli ki prasatana mekea tembereciti manaya. And I just want you to know, that you may break out into prayer at any moment in time, because this is a house of prayer.
Yeah.
It's supposed to be a house of prayer. It's supposed to be a house of praise. Everything that's going on should be producing prayer and praise.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, some people go run and hide. They say, well, if you talk nicer, then we could all prayer and praise. I've never experienced that ever in any meeting ever that I've ever been in. I've always, every word of God was a delight unto me.
Yeah.
I never experienced something going on where, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Everything that's going on should be. Now, if you're getting rebuked, that should be a delight to you, because now you don't have to live.
Yeah.
You don't have to live like you've been living anymore.
Yeah.
All messed up, sick and diseased and worried, and, you know, not having a hard time moving in faith, moving in things of God. You should be more happy than anybody else, because at that very moment, you discovered your entire problem is keeping you back from moving forward with God. Those should be the most happy people in the house.
Those
should be the most happy people in the house. It should be. It really should be. That, you know, we live in an age right now where everything is just really, everything is about, you know, motivation, telling everybody how wonderful they are, how great they are. There has never been such a community of people that want to just hear the things that, you know, that are just, you know, just wildly fantastic, that really result in they can do it all, they can be it all, they are it all. That's not real. It's not real. It's just not real. What's real is that Father has given us an opportunity to know Him, to walk with Him, to interact with Him. So I want you to open up your Bibles. Son, you can sit. Are you sitting down? Okay. You guys can come sit down. Hallelujah. Pikaramo manasiteya. You know, somebody says after a few days in fasting, you lose your hunger. Well, every once in a while, it comes back with roars. It comes back with roars. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Prapo tarana makistapaya. Yeshi levokara tavadaseka. Oh, Rafa Dizis. You got what I got. Shikambra dakashile. And every one of you can have what I have. Hallelujah. I love what among drek lak zebrunaya. Somebody says, you think you're special. Yeah, I'm in a congregation and a company of people baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire, doing the work of the ministry, living in divine health, living in divine freedom, living in divine blessings, hallelujah, living in divine faith, living divine life, hallelujah, hallelujah, I'm blessed coming in, going out, rising up, sitting down, amen, Father is in my midst, He burns like a fire in the midst of me, praise God, He hears my prayers, hallelujah, He answers me when I call, and oh, if you could just learn to call on the Lord when He's near. When the anointing of God is overwhelming, the presence of God's got you kind of bent over. The weightiness of His presence is just whew. Ah, then you start learning how to call on God when He's near, because it's an atmosphere of faith. Whoo! People try to talk to Father and call on Father. They've never learned how to develop an atmosphere of faith. They're just hoping that, you know, it's sounding out past, as it were, the walls of doubt and unbelief and discouragement and disappointment to surround them. Very difficult situation. All you can do is cry out to God until those walls come down, until those opposing forces are dissipated. Hallelujah.
Amen.
That's all you can do. That's all you can do. That's all you can do. And then faith begins to move. And now what you're doing, what you're saying, how you're interacting is really viable. It's real. Before it's not. It's not viable. God's not going to interact with anything but faith. He doesn't. All that pleases Father is faith. The only word interacts in the realm of the Holy Ghost. And many people allow too many layers of this earthly and worldly concerns to be imposed upon them. And I hope that some of you can begin to see it. And, You know, I heard some rumblings of, oh my, we can't go on the Facebook, can't even watch the news. Pastor said, can't even listen to the radio. And reality of it is, people don't complain too much, because if you could just stay away from a while, you'll find out how much is distracting you and how much it's keeping back from you. Just, you know, and it, you know, I'm not saying that it's all wrong. I'm not saying that you can't, you know, have a little bit of TV in your life, a little bit of, you know, CNN or Fox News or whatever it is that, you know, you think is telling you the truth. I'm just saying that you'll see that, wait a minute, there's an impact going on here. I'm allowing myself, because some people just soak the stuff. They're just sponging on it. And it's affecting you. Everything you watch and everything you hear sows spiritual seed. It just does. You can say it does it. You can make up all of your excuses. You can tell me how you can handle it and how you're a superior human being and all these other things. I'm telling you right now, it has a huge impact on you, for the good or for the bad. And, you know, most people should be wanting to have a place where their thoughts and their thinking realm is a sanctuary of communion with God. And you're not having to pull down one thing and pull down another. And that's the three movies you watched yesterday or whatever, you know, or the one. You have to pull down another and pull down another thing and have to deal with another influence because of the books that you read. You know, people want to try to say, well, he's talking legalism. He's a clothesline preacher. You know, if you don't know what a clothesline preacher, how many of you know what a clothesline preacher is? Okay, good. The rest of you, that means the preacher is looking back in the olden days before they had dryers. They took clothes and they hung them on a clothesline. And so the preacher could see what you're wearing, okay? And now he's expressing, you know, the kind of clothes you should wear. And so it was a thing that would be said about certain holiness preachers, other clothesline preachers, you got to dress a certain way to be right with God. And so then they talk about legalism and whatnot. No. It has nothing to do with that. It's just simply trying to give warnings and instruction on how to have communion, how to live in a sanctuary, how not to have all of these things running interference with you. Because, listen, a thought is the beginning of an act. A thought is the beginning of an act. Listen to me. A thought is the beginning of an act. A thought does not have to result in an act, but it is the beginning of an act. If the thought needs to, we need to learn how to deal with the battleground of our mind. We're going to have to understand that there is a battle going on there, and we're going to have to learn how to be very effective at it. And if it's something that's not holy, and if it's something that's not godly, and if it's something that's not true, and if it's something that's not of love, if it's something that is not of intercession, if it's not something that's not of the Holy Ghost, that we understand how to bring to bear spiritual weapons to be able to stop it. Not just, you know, some human responsible, oh, I can't think that way, oh, thought, bad thought, get away. Because nothing's going to happen. I mean, you're going to say, get away. And then as soon as you're not get away, it will come back to you at an opportune time. Huh? Yep. You know, actually, when Jesus got finished fasting after 40 days and he was hungry, the scripture says the devil departed from him until another opportune time. And he does. He lays in wait. I know how to get them. I know the moments of weakness. I know how they get when they're, you know, on vacation, or I know how they get when they get real tired or whatever. You know, I come back at an opportune time and show that I'm boss of their life. I mean, come on, people. If you could just really understand that's really what Satan's doing. He's trying to prove his point. I'm boss of their life. They'll dance anytime I bring my power to bear. As long as God's holding me back, yeah, they're okay. But just let the Lord give me an opportunity, you know, at any moment in time to give them a little bit of trying on them, huh? And I'll show them that they'll serve me and not you. And that's been going on and it continues to go on. And for me, it's fighting words. And when you finally realize it, you begin to understand it, your eyes begin to be open to the reality of the spiritual world. You begin to understand the effect and the play of fiery darts upon your life from the wicked one. You begin to understand spiritual wickedness that is embattling you. Suddenly, you recognize your need for the shield of faith, for the whole armor of God, for the strength of the Lord and the power of his might, for the ability to walk in the Spirit and live by the Spirit. Hallelujah. For doing right things and refusing wrong things, for having wisdom of what you allow in your life and where you go and who you fellowship with. and what you fellowship with. Because there's today in a modern age, everything is a virtual reality. We can bring in everything that is out there in the world right into our living room and be communing with wickedness and not even know what's going on. I walked in to pay for the oil change and the air filter thing in a business. And when I walked in, there was one of those guys sitting there with his virtual reality hood, the virtual reality hood on. And he just... this is a big thing now. I mean, it's just like, watch out, man. Everybody's going to be walking around. Because it's a 3D interactive thing or whatever. It's Lord Jesus. And of course, it's like the Christians are the biggest, market for a lot of these things. And then the preacher comes along and says, no, why don't you separate yourself in the fasting and prayer? That's going to go over like a lead balloon. No, why don't you separate yourself from all these things that the world is entertained by, everything that they're jumping up and down about and blowing their little party horns and wearing the little party hats and doing the little party shakers and jumping up and down about. And we're saying, no, you don't do that. Come over here and pray. What? You're keeping us from all the fun. No. No, we want to get you into the fun. We want to move you out of the deception and into reality. Because I'm going to tell you right now, once you encounter God, I'm telling you, you are riding high. I mean, the highest you can possibly imagine, mounting up with wings as an eagle, flying, not living out a virtual reality, living out the reality. All that is real and all that is true is only in God. All the rest of this is a fiction. It's a lie. And it can be proven to be a fiction, and it can be proven to be a lie, because it will result in you functioning in some form of the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, or the pride of life, which is nothing more than a demonic ploy to destroy your soul. And he did it through hooking you by a lie, some deception. That's why it can be proven. It's proven to be a lie and deception. That is not a subjective reasoning. That is a rational observation from the vantage point of knowing what belongs to God and what that results in. That's truth, that's reality, and what belongs to the realm of the satanic, which is a lie and deception, and the fruit or the result of that, of what that experience looks like. And so we just want you to get over here, and we want you to live forever. Father wants you to live forever. Father wants you to enjoy the glory and the beauty of all that his hands have made. People, it is a lot better to go snowboarding, really go snowboarding, than putting the thing on your head and sitting in a public place going, are you with me? Give me a break. It is like insane. It is embarrassing. I feel embarrassed for people. Give me a break. And we know that. We know that it's far better to go snowboarding than to put the little helmet on and do the little thing. Well, so is it better to live life in reality and truth than to live death in the deception and lie, no matter how fun it is made to look? Come on. It's just, the Lord give you wisdom and give you insight in Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah. Pastorita sikana mosifritia. Blessed is the name of the Lord. Open your Bibles. Very familiar verse of scripture. Genesis. No. It's kind of like a Genesis. John chapter 3. And really, John chapter 3 is the antithesis of Genesis chapter 3. Because Genesis chapter 3 was Satan inviting men into the realms of darkness. And John chapter 3 is Christ Jesus, God, inviting men into the realms of his glory and of his light. Hallelujah. Huh? And isn't it crazy? Men seem to be so easily persuaded to step right on over into darkness, into the full of it, but yet reluctant to respond to God to come over into life. Why? Because Satan's influence as the prince and the power of the air is that of a tyrant. It's forceful. God leaves you to make a choice. He's not going to have anybody serving him out of manipulation, out of threats, out of deception. Satan is a deceiver. He deceives. God doesn't deceive. He gives you the truth. And so now you're getting to respond to reality. Satan just deceives you with tyranny and deception and drags you, beating you upside the head, into whatever it is that he demands of you. And that's the big difference. That's why there's so many examples of why, how that impacts people and the effect, from Mormonism to Jehovah's Witnessism to all the other false things. It's just reality of it is there are so many people swept into that because of the deceptive, lying power that's with it. Islam, on and on. So John chapter 3, you there? Nicodemus comes to Jesus, says to him, Rabbi, recognizes, first and foremost, you know, let's keep in mind, this is a man who is a ruler of the Jews, and clearly in the Sanhedrin, probably a wealthy man, a man who ultimately is going to take care of Jesus' body along with Joseph of Arimathea. Two very prominent figures in Israel. Not everybody in Israel missed the Messiah. Most of the people in Israel, as is revealed in the scripture, rejected the Messiah, God incarnate, because they were envious of him, because he was taking from them their position. He was taking from them what they felt was their identity as a people, and that legacy continues on to this day. People that were prominent men like Nicodemus, who could have possibly, and many people believe this to be true, be the head of Sanhedrin, which you ultimately earned and deserved because you were more skilled in the scripture than anyone else. You are more skilled in the laws of God, more skilled in judgment than anyone else. So that promoted you. Unless, obviously, there were political things involved as well as there are in everything. But in most cases, you know, if you looked at it for the purest kind of presentation of it, it would have been the most worthy person who was ultimately head of the Sanhedrin. Here he is. He comes to him and he says, Rabbi, we know that you're a teacher sent from God, for no one could do these miracles that you are doing unless God is with him. Jesus is now going to bring him to a place that he's brought hopefully every one of us, and that you and I can stop and reflect continually on it, because we need the evaluation. We need the examination. He says, he stops Nicodemus right there, and he says, no one can encounter, experience, participate, see. And that's really what that particular word means. And I give a little bit of proof, a bit of an exegesis of it in my footnotes on John chapter 3, verse 3. You can go look that up. But the bottom line of it is, what he's saying is you can't participate, you can't encounter, you can't know or understand or see the kingdom of God until that you're born again. And he's going to tell us very clearly what it means to be born again. He's going to tell us that we're going to become people of the Spirit. God is a spirit, and they that worship God must worship him in spirit. He's going to tell us that we're going to become people of the Spirit. In doing so, he's telling Nicodemus that he's not a person of the Spirit. He's telling all humanity that they're not people of the Spirit. And we're talking about the Spirit of God. And, you know, sometimes people have a hard time understanding this because, well, they say, well, Daniel had the Spirit of God. Joseph had the Spirit of God. Listen, there are other explanations for that so you can understand that more perfectly. The reality of it is Jesus is looking at humanity. He's not only looking at Nicodemus, he's looking at all men. And he's telling them, you can't participate with, you cannot encounter, you cannot be a part of, you cannot understand, you cannot see, you cannot encounter the realms of the kingdom of God until you're born again, until you are born of the Spirit. And then he tells us that those who are born of the Spirit are spirit. And now we begin to deal with something, because now he's going to contrast for us being born of the Spirit versus just being born of humanity. And, you know, people get it, they get things messed up and they get it confused because they used the word flesh, and now they've applied the word flesh to not only that which represents humanity, but that which represents the demonic, and the list goes on. And now they're all confused. No. He's telling us that we have transitioned from a realm of living as a human being to now living in the realms of the Spirit, to living in the realms of the kingdom of God, to living in a place of cooperation and participation with God. Now, to understand this a little bit more perfectly, I'm going to take you through a couple of layers, and I'm going to start off with John chapter 16, and then going to move to 1 Corinthians chapter 2, and just look at a couple of layers, because what the Lord's going to explain a little bit more is he's going to tell us that the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of truth, is going to come, and he's going to be our teacher. He's going to be our helper. He's going to be our leader. He's going to be our guide. He says, I am going to send you another one just like me, okay? I'm going to send you another one. I'm going to send you another person. I'm going to send you another helper. I'm going to send you another mentor. I'm going to send you another teacher, another leader, another parakalitos, just like me. So, and that's context. If you're really exegeting this properly, and understand, Jesus is the exegete of God. He is the revelation and unveiling of God. If you're going to exegete this properly, then you have to look at it in the context of 12 apostles walking around with Jesus, learning how to move in miracles, learning how to live their life, learning how what to do, what not to do. When they're debating among themselves who should be greatest, Jesus is going to step in and go, guys, you're totally blowing it now. You're totally thinking, you know, if they step out like Peter and start saying things that are inappropriate, he's going to say, get behind me, Satan. And if they're like a lot of people in the church today, they're never coming back to the meeting. Can you believe what he did publicly? Did you hear what he said publicly? Publicly, he embarrassed me. He said, get behind me, Satan. How does everybody know that he wasn't calling me Satan? Pride of life. Pride of life. As soon as you are offended by the word of God, you are sorted out. Amen. You're sorted out. Amen. It isn't my fault, it's your fault. Oh, and he was just nicer. Well, tell Jesus about that. Yeah, tell the Holy Ghost about that. He's got some real serious ways of leveling the truth with all plainness of speech. Amen. Tell Apostle Paul about it. Tell anybody who has ever moved with God by God that they should have a kinder way of speaking, because they were all harsh madmen in the perspective of people. Why? Because the human realm has another definition of what's good and what they like and what is normal. And it is those things that tend to and serve their interests of their own pride of life, their own arrogance, their own haughtiness, their own built-up fantasy of who they believe themselves to be. Can you hear me?
Yes.
I hope I'm using words that are not hard to understand. I hope I don't have to do great expositions on trying to just deal with what should be obvious and what the Bible has made very obvious, and which, by the way, the only power against it is giving yourself to humility and meekness. It's the only power against it. And the only one that's going to be able to give you true humility and meekness where it's not false is the Holy Ghost. And to do that, you're going to have to learn how to live in the Spirit and walk in the Spirit and be who God made you to be. And if you somehow have wrong models that say, no, this is acceptable, no, this is okay, no, this is really what it looks like, then you're going to have a propensity to follow those wrong models, and you better get that right. Reality of it is the Word of God should have always been correcting you, because as soon as you read the Word of God, the Holy Ghost amplifies it and turns it up full volume. He does. As soon as you read the Word of God, he amplifies it and says, see how wrong those wrong models are? Hallelujah. So to see Roman Kegla Mahate. Somebody says, where are you at? I said, I'm over here in John chapter 16. I wanted to kind of get started at verse 7, just kind of help you understand. When he comes, what is he going to do? He's going to convince men. He's going to persuade men. He's going to convict men. He's going to reprove men. Oh, please. Please, if you do that, you have no wisdom or insight in terms of how to grow a church and care for God's people. Oh, no, I've heard this is a common mantra, and I'm using the word, even though it is from another religion, I'm using it consciously in this context. It is a mantra by so many people. That if you're saying anything negative, if it's anything convicting, if it's anything reproof, then it's categorically condemnation, and you have no understanding, you have no wisdom, no insight how to build a church and how to care for God's people. Well, you know what? You need to go talk to Father. You know, you need to go talk to every prophet in the Bible, because they were all messed up. And some of these guys will say, yeah, they were all messed up. I heard one famous preacher saying, I didn't actually hear him, I read about it, one famous preacher say that John was was a dysfunctional, heartbroken preacher who was overwhelmed with disappointment and discouragement and took it out on people and abused them. So that's what you get when you read John, 1st, 2nd, 3rd epistle of John, and the book of Revelation. And the book of Revelation is their high point of how messed up he was. He just wanted God to come destroy everybody. And he wanted God to come destroy everybody in the cruelest way possible. Okay, so, you know, if you want to listen to those people, because they're not going to say that really necessarily in public, necessarily. And they're going to have their nice hairdos, and they're going to have their Rolex watches on. They're going to have their 15-karat diamonds, and everything's going to be flashing and looking, and they're going to be, like, prophesying, and, you know. If you want to listen to that, you can listen to that. But I advise you to get your reference manual out. Yes. I advise you get the dictionary out called the Bible. I advise you to just wait and make sure that everything's being said is appropriate, is correct, that really the main point isn't how much money you're going to make off your offering and off your giving. The main point is the fruits of righteousness and fruits of holiness. Amen. Hello. Yes. The main point isn't how much you're going to have in this life. It's how much you're going to have in the life hereafter. The main point isn't about the wealth in a monetary system. It is about the wealth in the realms of the Spirit. That's the main point. The main point isn't about signs and wonders and miracles. The main point is about overcoming sin and walking with God. Amen. The main point is about loving God. Yes. Hallelujah. Not being successful and famous. Come, we're going to teach you how to be successful and famous, how to build your church. If you've got 50, we're going to take you to 5,000. If you've got 5, we're going to take you to 500. You will not catch me there. Because I would come under the anointing and I would have to start prophesying. I'd have to make a belt. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Well, you know what? I'm just going to stand here in this place and hallelujah. Just say what God said. Just be faithful with His word. And God is sovereignly going to make people hungry for truth. Because they're going to get burned out on the lie. They're going to get burned out on the falsehood. They're going to find out, wait a minute. You know, they're going to be at crossroads. They're going to find out that what they're hearing and what they're doing is not resulting in them being an overcomer. So they're going to do one or two things. They've got to say, really, they've got to invalidate the need to be an overcomer and make sin okay and wrongdoing acceptable, or they're going to have to say, wait a minute, I'm not getting what I need in order to be what God's described me to be. And so once again, it's just another level, another bifurcation of deeper fantasy, deeper deception, deeper lie, or willing to turn back to God. And if you're on that, listen, if you ever get on that or any part on that, I believe that what Joel said applied. Return unto me, as the Lord said, with fastings and prayer. You know, and it's not just returning unto the Lord, fasting and prayer with respect to, hey, look, I know I've been led down a wrong place and I've allowed wrong thinking and wrong attitudes and wrong behavior to be built up in my life. I love it, and you should have it in your life at least once a year, because it just causes you to reevaluate, and especially if it's an extended period of time. I mean, not just one day. You're not going to do anything but think about how hungry you are for one day. Okay, you understand me? We're all in this thing together. You say fasting and praying. I could pray a whole lot better when I wasn't fasting, and just that I neglected it. But nonetheless, we won't think about that. I could pray a whole lot better when I wasn't fasting, because I can't even think about prayer right now. I'm just like, whoa. Yeah, I'm hungry. You know, I'm so weak. Yeah. You'll get over that after about 2 days. You'll get over that. About third, fourth, fifth day, prayers start kicking in with a greater boldness. You'll be able to do it. I promise you. And then you get to reevaluate all the things that you've now made common, you've accepted, to become norms in your life. You just shut it all down. Wait a minute. And you get to find out whether you're addicted to coffee or not. You get to find out if you're addicted to caffeine. Huh? Because you just shut it all down. All of a sudden the Lord gets to speak to you, because you're not just bombarded with all this stuff that you are justifying. And He's saying, I really don't like those programs you've been watching. He'll say that to you. He'll say that to you. And it will come with Holy Ghost conviction. You can try to rebuke it all you want, but it'll keep coming back at you. The devil will never say, listen, I just do not like the programs that you've been watching. He will never do that. So you can rebuke it all you want. It's never, Satan's like going, more, do more. Worse, deeper, darker. God's called us to come into a place where we can be led by the Spirit. First and foremost, he's come to reprove, he's come to rebuke, he's come to convince, he's come to correct of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment. Of sin, why? Because they believe not on me. Huh? Of righteousness, why? Can you tell me? Anybody? Huh? Of righteousness, why? Because I go to my Father. Well, what on earth does that mean, of righteousness, because I go to my Father? Well, I should back up to the first one. Of sin, because they believe not on me. Because listen, I'm going to tell you right now, when you believe upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, his blood, and you get into the faith the way that the faith was once delivered unto saints, his blood will wash you and cleanse you from all sin, and all sin and its power will lose its effect over you. That there is therefore no condemnation in Christ Jesus, who has made us free from the law of sin and death. Praise God. Of sin because they believe not on me. Of righteousness because I go to the Father. Because that him going to the Father is that sealed righteousness now, where that the resurrection of the dead is being referred to in his exaltation, that his life has been imparted, and that we've received the righteousness of God. What is the Holy Ghost doing? He's convicting, he's correcting, he's convincing. If there's sin going on in their life, he's dealing with your belief, your relationship, your faith in Christ Jesus, your walk with God. He's dealing fundamentally with believing on Christ Jesus. He's not dealing with all these other things that we want to make it. He's dealing with the relationship. Belief, faith, trust, that's relationship. It's relationship language. It's not religious language. It's not a religious thing, okay? It is a relationship thing. There's no way you can have faith in someone you don't have a relationship with. Obviously, I misappropriated that word because it should never be used in a reference to another human being, but it helps you understand it that much better. Because we utilize it that way. But the reality of it is faith only belongs to God. It's a divine thing, and it belongs to relationship with God. And it comes to us by measure to begin with that he's given to every single man. And it doesn't have to come by measure and increase and grow over a long period of time. Because as we ministered to you last Sunday morning, the Syrophoenician woman got it instantaneously. She got great faith. Huh? While the disciples are walking around with no faith, a little faith. You know, are you listening to me? The followers, they're just always like, just dragging them along, It's so sad. The Syrophoenician, she gets it, The Centurion, she gets it. The guys that show up for the meeting and they're there faithfully, there's like, please, Lord. Praise God for Pentecost. Pentecost is all that changes that. Pentecost sorts it out. It makes lame-os into those great champions in the Holy Ghost, in God. It's true. It's that fire that burns, that tries things and tests it, because it's like with Simon. They didn't know. Simon wasn't any different. Seemed to be the same as everybody else who gave their life to Jesus and was baptized in water that some people say are going to be are saved forever. But Simon, Peter and John comes down with the ministry of the Holy Ghost, and this ministry of the Holy Ghost sorts out Simon. And then as soon as Simon is there confronted with the baptism of the Holy Ghost and fire, he's discovered to have no part in the company of the redeemed, to be under the bondage of Satan. There's a lot of, tradition about that all he did was get offended and go and start another sect. And I don't want to go into that, but I can believe that tradition simply because I watch it repeated over and over and over again. People get offended. I'm a really good litmus test for whether or not you can be offended. And there's other preachers like me too, praise God. If I was the only one, I'd feel a little bit more awkward. I would be constantly, I'd be fasting more. I'd be skinnier. Because you're just like, wait a minute, there's just no way I could be the only one doing this. There's no way that I could be the only one getting this thing right. You just like, you would have a real complex, right? But praise God, there is a lot in the company of people. And I get to study in the history of the church, and I found that the people that God used to change the church were people that were radical, people that were called offensive, people that were unbending, unwavering, demanding these things which God demanded. So I'm happy to be in that company. I'm not trying to fit in that company. I'd want to fit in that company. God's made me to fit in that company. He brought me into the ministry. Hallelujah. He's put me in the ministry. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
He's done it. And I just want to be found and counted worthy to to step into all the fullness of walking in the ministry of Jesus. I don't want this year in 2017 to encounter one sick and diseased person that doesn't get cured.
Amen.
This year. I want to have His words, His presentation, His representation, the representation of the kingdom for every single person that He brings me in contact with as we begin to travel now. We're getting ready to go to Texas, then we're going to go to Georgia, then we're going to Alaska, to Juneau, Alaska. God is going to all these different places. And so, you know, the reality of it is I've got to be willing to become sensitive to the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Not just in some ways. I praise God for the areas that I'm sensitive to the Holy Spirit in. I praise God. And I praise God for the areas that you're sensitive to the Holy Spirit in. But if you're just satisfied with that and you don't want to move on and you don't want to correct it and reality of it is that some people become in bondage to past failures and experiences and situations, offenses, literally carrying unforgiveness. They're a prisoner of unforgiveness. And so they can never move forward. And that's why reality of it is, once again, we're right here at the first of the year. I'm still at the first year. I'm still celebrating the first of the year with the 21-day fast. You with me?
Yeah.
Because I'm on purpose not to carry anything from 2016 into 2017.
Amen.
And if I'm purpose not to take anything from 2016, I'm definitely not taking for anything from 2015 or 2014. I'm definitely not going back to 1987. I'm definitely not going back to 1972. Are you with me?
Yes.
Or 1965. Uh-oh. Huh? Or 1963. That's 4 years old. First time that I could remember running down the altar, crying out, "Oh God, Daddy, God," and every other name of authority that I knew. I don't want to go to hell. My dad preached one of those sermons. I'm not going to bring any of that stuff with me. I'm going into the new.
Amen.
I'm on a grand adventure. I want to go where God wants to take me. I want to sit in some prison of past and bad experience, whether it was sickness, whether it was disease, whether it was unforgiveness, whether it was whatever it is. I'm not taking it with me. I'm not taking it with me. And neither you just have to, every one of us, we have the choice, because God empowers us first and foremost with a choice and then backs that choice up with supernatural divine ability to come in and blow all that stuff off. Decimate it. The power of His word is dynamite power. Blow it all up. Hallelujah. The power of the Holy Ghost, dynamite power. Explosive power. Blow it all up. Hallelujah. Boom. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Then you just watch the little particles and fragments of the past floating by. Hallelujah. No power, no effect over me. Praise God. Man, when you come into an agreement with the Holy Ghost, you let the Holy Spirit talk to you. All He's going to talk to you about is He's going to talk to you about empowerment. He's going to talk to you about greatness. He's going to talk to you about divine authority. He's going to talk to you about abundant life. And He's going to also talk to you in the context and warn you of the things that will keep you from it. And that's what people don't like. That's the rebuke. And He says, and He's going to convince, reprove, correct. He's going to make known things of judgment. And why? What is He going to talk about judgment? He's going to say, it's already done. The world has been judged. He's going to say, look, this isn't something that's going to be subjective. If you do good, and after all, you know, the Lord knows what all you've been through, and He's just feeling so sorry for you. That you've been through some things that nobody else has been through, so He's going to give you some exemptions. Some special credits. Some indulgences. True. They had a whole doctrine. God had God all written into indulgences and why some people should be able to get them, why some shouldn't be able to get them. Nothing's changed. It isn't just so overt anymore. It's not just, you know, look, you know, today, if you bring, today, special day. On the way here, I got a special revelation from God. Anybody brings me $10,000, I'm going to give you 4 indulgences. Bring an extra 10,000, we're going to get one of your relatives out of hell. You And it went on. And it went over there. It went over in there. And praise God. You know, the Lord used that to stir up people. You know, like, there's a list of them. I need to go through all of them. I'm stirred. Are you stirred?
Yeah.
So, this is why you were born of the Spirit, so you can encounter the Holy Ghost. You are born of the Spirit to become Spirit, to be one with the Spirit. He that is joined on the Lord is one Spirit with the Lord. Our Spirit joined unto His Spirit, so that you and I could receive from the Holy Ghost, walk with the Holy Ghost, learn from the Holy Ghost, in every way of our life be conformed to what He's showing us to be by model Christ Jesus. Not by any other model. All other models are false models. Why can't we get that? Why? Where is the disconnect on this? It is so evident. Once again, and that comes back to the whole ploy of deception. Deception, those who are deceived don't know they're deceived. The Lord hid these things from the wise and the prudent. So sometimes I'm like frustrated going, why is it so difficult for people to get? The Lord reminds me of those two categories right there. Whew, I don't want to be in either one of those categories. I don't want to be deceived, neither do I want to be wise and prudent in my own eyes, because then I can't receive what God's saying. He's hid it from the wise and prudent, and He revealed it unto babes. People who are just going to be simple with God's word and say, here's what He said, let's just do it. Let's don't try to write our own doctrines around that, try to explain it, say that every scripture, this is one of Satan's biggest lies. The Bible is open for interpretation. Everybody interprets it differently. I would love for someone to say that to me in a debate. I heard someone say that to a person in a debate recently, and I'm like, oh, let me in. Come on, tag out. Let me in. I'll shut that thing down right now. Come on, people, you and I, we need to give ourselves to being champions in the kingdom of God. And how are we going to do that? Spirit of wisdom and counsel and might. Spirit of knowledge and understanding, to where nobody can resist our wisdom. No one can resist our understanding in the Word of God. Father, the Holy Ghost, the Father teamed up with the Holy Ghost will give us skills in His and understanding and wisdom to speak His Word, to where no one can resist us. And that's not going to be all about just studying. Yeah, you need to study. Show yourself approved, a workman that does not need to be shamed. Yes, you need to give yourself to really understanding the doctrines of God. But that isn't going to be the means by which that authority is executed. That's going to be executed by the Holy Ghost. He's the one who connects all the dots. He's the one who gives wisdom and insight and instruction, like you see as it's reported concerning Daniel, who is in wisdom and knowledge from the Spirit of the Lord, was 10 times better than everybody else. And the insights and revelation that they had and understanding that they had to times and seasons and what was going on. Come on. Yeah. That's who we're supposed to be. Yes. I want that. Yes. I want to be that. I want you to be that. Yes. God the Holy Ghost makes us that. He gives us the hunger. He gives us the motivation. He gives us the insight. He gives us the revelation. And He's there. He's saying, okay, He's watching us. He's a part of this. He's not just doing and interacting based upon a request. He's doing and interacting based upon our obedience with that request. He sees us. Oh, Lord, I want to understand. I want to know. I want to see. I want to be filled with Your wisdom. I want to be filled with Your understanding. He sees us. Start at Genesis again. He sees it. And now He's going to be right there going, oh, well, let me show you something this time. Look at that. You're going, wow. Have I ever read the Bible before? This is amazing. That's Him. His eyes are a rewarder. And it's not some reward at the end of all of the agony. It is a continual, ongoing reward in relationship. Huh? Hey, baby, I'm going to give you a kiss just before we die. Mean now we don't kiss. You know, that's my last word. No, it's relationship. It's interactive. It's hugs. I mean, it's hugs. It's Him looking at us. It's Him calling us. It's Him hugging us. It's Him interacting with us. I mean, it's like, this is real stuff. It's just you and I getting hooked up with it. And He's made a way for you and I to be hooked up with it in a miraculous event. It's called being born again. It's calling upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's coming to Him and asking Him for that which He alone can supply. He's the only one who can give it. He's the Savior. He's the Redeemer. He's the one that sent the Holy Ghost. God is going to do what He does based upon the request of Jesus Christ, who came and redeemed us with His own blood, gave His life for us, who rose from the dead, who is exalted Lord of lords and King of kings, far above all power and principality. Anyone who calls upon His name, He will respond. At that response of Christ Jesus, the Holy Ghost will come and invade your life. And he does it. He does it on the level of making us anew. He makes us new. There is no such thing as a hybrid of the new with the old, a hybrid with the spirit of the spirit with the flesh. It doesn't exist any more than there's a hybrid of light with darkness. There is no such existence as is there as there's no more hybridization of the spirit with the flesh as there is with God and Satan. None. It's invalidated because you've removed the distinct separation that Jesus Christ made so evidently at the very introduction of what it means to receive His life, of what He's talking about. You have to completely go out of context to make it something else. If it's not obvious, talk to me. Come on. Because it's just so plain and simple. In the Word of God, we got to quit hybridizing things and pairing things together that have no association with each other at all. Amen. Okay, they're not equal. Amen. There's no relationship in any way. Now, we have to deal with that personally, not doctrinally only. We've got to deal with it doctrinally, otherwise we're confused. We don't know how to navigate. Huh? We have to understand that this is the Word of God. This is what He's saying to us. Now we've got to recognize, wait a minute, I want this applied. I understand it. Now I want it to be applied. I understand what God is saying. Now I want it to be applied. I want it to be the real living experience that I give myself to, because I have to be a participant with it. I've got to participate with the kingdom of God. I've been allowed now to encounter the kingdom of God, to see the kingdom of God, participate with the kingdom of God, understand the kingdom of God. And people say, well, wait. Isn't the kingdom of God coming in the future? Yes, it is. Physically, it's coming in the future, but it's spiritually here right now. It's here right now. Paul said to the church of Colossians, Colossians 1:13, he said, you've been translated from the kingdom of this world, and the kingdom of dear Son. The kingdom of dear Son is the kingdom of Christ Jesus, which is the kingdom of God. It's what's happening right now. It is that which the Holy Spirit brings to us. Hallelujah. We understand that even back in the days of Daniel, God ruled in the kingdom of men. If He ruled in the kingdom of men, and that was what He was earnest to make known to the greatest ruler of that day and time, King Nebuchadnezzar, which God highlighted as the greatest ruler that had ever been and the greatest kingdom that had ever been. He highlighted it as that. In the image of gold, the golden head all the way down to the feet of iron and clay in Daniel chapter 2. And he earnestly convinced this man, Nebuchadnezzar, this king of kings, that he was the one who rules in the kingdom of men. God was earnest to make that known. He wants that made known to you and me, because somehow we don't understand that. We want to believe that governmental powers and that Satan has some more influence, but really we don't even look at satanic influence. We're more fixated on men and governments. And Father is earnest to convince us that He rules. Yes. Yes. He rules. Yes. If you'll start talking to God like this, and one of the things I love about Adeboye is that he began to find out his prayer life, and he talks a lot about his prayer life, and really what it is, and he explains it differently, but the way I perceive it and the way I look at it and value it is that he began to grasp the reality of who God is by constantly telling God who He is. And suddenly it's not something that God needs. It's something that you and I need. And as we begin to give ourselves over into that realm in participation with the Holy Ghost, suddenly there's an unveiling of spiritual wisdom and revelation to cause us to realize, wait a minute, I'm living in God's world. He rules here. He's the one who raises up. He's the one who casts down. He's the one who builds. He's the one who tears down. He's the one who plucks up. He's the one who plants. He's God Almighty. And if it was so in Daniel's day, how much more is it now? That much more a reality now, because the spiritual world is different now. In Daniel's day, the prince of Persia and the prince of Grecia could stop the revelation of what God, who rules in the kingdom of men, wanted to deliver to his person, his servant, Daniel. Now that spiritual realm has completely been annihilated by Christ Jesus, who spoiled principalities and powers and made a display openly that they were defeated, hallelujah, and that he had triumphed. And he's lo rapaya, above all principality, power, and might. And you and I are together with him in that authority. So there is no excuse for sin. There is no excuse for anything that Satan would try to put on us, sickness, disease. It just doesn't belong in the camp. Now, Satan is a rebel. He don't believe that, and he don't believe that you believe that, and so he's going to impose upon you in his tyranny things he has no right to, and the only power to stop that is for you to rise up and say no. Recognize your authority, who you are in God, and say, you have no right with the authority that Christ Jesus gives in that realm of faith, and Father backs that up. Father backs it up when you stand up. And having done all, stand, you stand. That's right. Satan is a tyrant. He's a rebel. He's convinced of nothing. He's not submitted to or in agreement with God on any single subject or word. And especially on you, he's not in agreement with God concerning who you are and what you're allowed to do with respect to him. Now, if you could just understand this, God the Holy Spirit wants to teach you, because only so much can be imparted by the words that I'm telling you. God the Holy Spirit has got to invade your life because you're willing to participate with them and give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that your eyes are open. You can be one of the people whose eyes are opened, who you can see this thing. You look at the clouds and you know you're basically looking right in the vicinity of the throne of God, because you know he's here. You know he's here. Amen. And that he rules here, and that this is his world, and you're living in his house. Amen. There are so many proofs of this. I'm not going to go into the things that are men's experience, because that's more subjective, even though they're real. And even though many experiences I could tell you that I've heard and learned over the years, I know they're valid, I know they're real, I know they're true. Still, they are subordinate. They are not as powerful, they're not as influential as the Word of God itself. Now, people make the witness of men and the experience of men more influential than the Word of God, but it isn't. It has seemingly more influence within the framework of the sensation and that which you are excited about in the sense realm and the thinking realm, but it has no spiritual impact like the Word of God, which is his seed that produces something eternal and spiritual, lasting in the heavens, that where faith begins to work, where God himself backs up all that he says and all that he does, proven by the universe and all that is in it. That's what his Word does. And we know somebody's testimony. That's his Word, who works, his Word that works powerfully, with divine power, effectually, in us who believe. You know, I'm going to get at this, and I'm going to get a little ahead of myself, but people ask me, why do you do why do you spend every tiyaka in my heart? Why do you spill into the butu pramaniki? Why do you give yourself over to the batuta? Why is it that you want a berikale anamusu? What is all about kiyara and masisa tanamanda and the value of it? It's learning the realms of the Spirit. Amen. It's learning the realms of the Spirit. Amen. Never before did man have the opportunity to function with God in the realms that the new covenant has provided for us. And thus, never before was such a gifting where the Spirit of the living God now begins to speak through you and me in a heavenly language, in an utterance of the mysteries of the Spirit speaking unto God, as is in the New Covenant, in the New Testament time, so that we can learn to function in the realms of something that is unseen and supernatural. He's the teacher training us to walk in the Spirit, to live by the Spirit, to be Spirit, to be convinced that we are Spirit. And that is everything about living in the kingdom of God, participating with God, this oneness with him, functioning in his glory, being one with him, abiding, dwelling in Christ Jesus as a branch is in the vine, being what Jesus said that we are supposed to be in John 17, 21 through 23. When he said, Father, the glory you gave to me, I've given it to them that they can be one just like you and I are one. And then he makes it very specific. Lord, as you are in me, I in them, huh? And they and us, right? The total interaction with oneness, spirit, walking in the Holy Ghost. Somebody said, "How do I learn how to do that? How do I learn how to do that?" Participating with the Word of God and the Spirit of God, doing, hearing the Word of God. The Spirit of the Son cries out, "Abba, Father, here's the Word of God. I want to do that." Every bit of the model of who Jesus is, who's been born into our life, Christ in us, our confidence, our hope of glory. Some people say our confidence of glory. Agreeing with everything and wanting and desiring everything that the Bible describes us to be. To where that we want humility. We want submission. We want brokenness. We want lowliness. We want love. We want to walk in all these things that belong to His virtue, that belong to His excellence of character, that belong to His glory. Well, why, when people start drawing back and say, "Oh, he's talking bad about me," that's a demon spirit. That's demon spirit. It's not Holy Spirit. But yet many of God's people have no ability to discern between evil and good. They have no ability to discern between the influence of a demon spirit and the influence of the Holy Spirit. None. Or very little. They hear voices. They have no ability to hear. They hear suggestions all the time. They're so used to giving themselves over to entering into strife, having envy, having an argument, having some kind of discord going on with somebody, that their ear is wide open, their spirit is wide open to the realms of the demonic. So they hear that voice, especially against the anointed ones, against the chosen ones, against God's covenant people. They hear it. They have no ability to discern the voice of the enemy and the voice of the Spirit of God. Why? Because they don't give themselves to the Word of God. Only the Word of God gives you the ability to exercise senses to discern between the voice of God and the voice of the demonic, between that which is lie and that which is truth, that which is good and that which is evil. Period. We need to participate here, people. You're going to have to grab all these things. You're going to have to recognize there is no way for you to be sloppy with God. You might have been able to be sloppy in art class, sloppy in math, sloppy in history, sloppy in your bedroom, sloppy with the rest of your stuff. You can't be sloppy with God. You're going to have to learn how to be disciplined with the Lord. And it's a good discipline. It's a good training, because it's a training. It's a relationship training. It's a love thing going on here. It's not this excuse train. Hallelujah. It's not an excuse train. It's the training of the Holy Ghost. And so the Lord tells us, praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. I'm going to send you someone just like me. He's going to lead you and He's going to guide you into all truth. Say some truth. Say some truth. Huh? No, when I say some truth, you're supposed to say no. Huh? I want you to follow me, but not beyond the Word. Am I making myself very clear?
Yes.
He'll lead us and guide us into all truth. Say some truth.
All
Amen. Hallelujah. And I'm very for that, because now that's submission to God, not submission to men. People still, Satan, you got to grow and mature to be able to even begin to sort this stuff out, because the enemy, if he's got any place to create within you wrong ideas, wrong thoughts, you've listened to him in any way, you've got behavior and mannerisms that clearly are not the Holy Ghost, you got to recognize you can't trust yourself. Huh? I'm going to tell you right now. When I'm fasting and praying, I can't trust myself. Because my brain shuts down sometimes. I'm good just being in the living room praying. But I shouldn't be driving some places and doing some things because I'm just not thinking right. Huh? If you're giving place to any kind of ideas, thinking, thought, mannerism, you shouldn't trust yourself. You grab a hold of yourself and say, "Oh God, oh God, oh God, oh God, help me, help me, help me. Oh Lord, shut down these voices. They're all lies." But no, that's not what people do. They sit there and think that they've got some kind of divine insight where, when it's reality, when the reality of it is, it's a familiar spirit. It's a lying spirit trying to keep them from the truth. Saying, "I agree," or "I disagree," or "I don't like," or "I do like," and all these other preferences. Hold up, hold up, hold up, hold up. Huh? This ain't a dialogue between you and the Holy Ghost. Huh? Are you listening to me?
Yes.
This is Him giving instruction.
Yes.
We're shut. We don't speak. We're not asked. Look. You can ask questions in a certain context, but is this what you mean? Am I supposed to pray like this? Am I supposed to put my hand on like this? Am I supposed to, you know. But you're not sitting there interacting with him on, hey, listen, do I have to love everybody? I mean, this person, I shouldn't have to love them. Huh? Can I yell every once in a while when I feel like it? Can I just let it out? The doctor said I needed a bit more. The Holy Spirit's not even entering into that dialogue. He's not going to even interact with that. That's just doubt and unbelief. It's anti-God. He's not even talking. He's not even talking. He's come to lead us and guide us into all truth. All truth, not some truth. Some guy was sitting, some preacher was sitting there telling me how that all of us have a little bit of little parts of the truth, and if we'll all bring them together, we'll see the whole picture, and trying to give me this allegory of an elephant and six blind men. Like, I patiently sit there and listen to the allegory of elephant and six blind men. And now that I'll bring little parts to the table and we're all going to get the whole thing. And I said, but the scripture says he will lead me and guide me into all truth. It's personal. It's individual. By context. Let's exegete this. He's not saying nothing about six blind men and an elephant. Because there are so many different ways he could have said that. Every one of you are going to be led in certain dimensions of the truth by the Holy Ghost. And for this cause is why you need to come together and submit yourself one to another. Because as you do, then the full truth will be unveiled as you walk in such humility and brokenness and submission and agreement and love among yourselves. He didn't say that. He did not say that. It might sound like scripture, but it ain't scripture. It might sound like I try to bring together some, you know, clearer understanding of what God has said, which is impossible, by the way. Can you think about that with me in a minute? Clearer understanding of what God said. Oh, man's going to do that. If anybody, somebody was reported, somebody was in the meeting here or somebody in the church that went around telling people, if anybody misunderstood what I said, see them because they could clear it up. And that is a weak and a comparison to you and I saying that we're going to give a clearer presentation of what God has declared concerning himself. It's just real simple here. The Holy Spirit has come to lead us and guide us into all truth, and it's just that simple. And we got all truth if we're willing to walk with him. I mean, John gets radical with it and says, we know all things. Ha! Because we have the unction of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah! That is heavy, man. We know all things. Wow. We know all things concerning his salvation, what his pleases him, what he desires, because it's all manifested in Jesus. Because all John's talking about is the manifestation of Jesus, the manifestation of truth, the manifestation of reality, the manifestation of that which really knows God and has relationship with God. That's his whole thesis of the first epistle. Hello. Praise the name of Jesus. He will take everything that belongs to, Jesus said, he will take everything that belongs to the Father. He said, he'll take everything that belongs to me and he shall reveal it unto you. He said, all things that the Father has is mine. Therefore said I, he shall take everything that belongs to, I said that wrong, didn't I? Did I say that wrong? He shall take everything that belongs to the Father and shall reveal it unto you. Right? All that the Father has is mine. Therefore, said I, he shall take everything that belongs to the Father, right? And shall reveal it, disclose it, make it known. Transmit it. Is everybody with me?
Yes.
Anybody have any comments? Did I quote it right? Because it's very important. It's very important that we get it right, that we understand it right. Huh? It's very important that we get this relationship that's going on between Father and the Lord Jesus and the Holy Ghost. And our part in that, huh? Is the Holy Ghost cheating on Father?
No.
Well, then why would we be in it? Because we're like right in the number. We get to be in the, we're in the group. We're not outsiders. We'd be all bummed out if we're outsiders. I get to be a part. I don't get to be a part. Well, now he's made you a part. Now you're acting like you don't want to be a part. Huh? Why does that go on with people like that? Huh? They want everything they can have, and once they got it, they don't want it. What is wrong? What's wrong with us? Can somebody please explain it? God's given us a new heart and a new spirit. He's made a new creature. It's a new creation. It's created in him. It's created by him. It's like him. He's reproduced himself in us. Praise God. He's given us the Holy Ghost. I'm still like running around the place and shout and say, oh God, this is what you did for me. I'm talking to this. Oh, you got to repeat this. You got to learn it. You got to grab a hold of it. It shouldn't be offensive to you. It should be rejoicing to you. It should be exaltation to you. It's like this is eternal life to know God and His Son that He sends for us, that He's given to us. That you and I have the Son. He that has the Son, I have the Son. I have the Son of God. He that hath the Son has life. He that does not have the Son does not have life. I have the Son. I have the Son of God. I got Jesus right here. I got Him. I have Him. He's in me and I'm in Him. Praise God. And every time you have a confession of that, or you shout or a praise, the glory of it comes out and is manifested. Try this. When you're talking to people on the phone, you know, work relationships, people that, you know, maybe you're doing business with or a store, and they say something good, say, praise God. I was sitting the other day in a room. Oh, Manny was there. And some people were looking, because I'm talking to someone at Home Depot, and they said, your thing's in there. No, it wasn't Home Depot. It was a rental place. And they said, your thing is in, or whatever it was. I said, praise God. You know, the people on the other end of the phone, they're getting all happy. And they look, come on, let's just start being who we are and start being the people of heaven. You need to be the people of the Spirit. Not religiously, because any religious little praise God, I was just, give me that phone. Praise God. Here. You're no religious little hallelujah. It's got to be of the Spirit. It can't be coming out of the realms of that which is not walking in the Spirit and living by the Spirit. It's living purely human, all messed up with discouragement, all messed up with doubt, all messed up with confusion, all messed up with strife, all messed up with the argument, all messed up with lust, all messed up with envy, all compromised with all this stuff. It's not going to come out. The realms of the Holy Ghost is not going to come out of that. It's not going to come out. You got to learn how to talk to Father. Amen. And when you learn how to talk to Father properly by the fervency of the prayer of the Holy Ghost, then when you begin to speak on His behalf, or you begin to praise Him, or you begin to declare anything concerning who He is, there's the fire of God with that. Amen. So you have to understand that you got to learn the value of prayer. Amen. You have to learn the value of prayer. Yeah. You got to learn the value of having your tongue lit on fire by the Holy Ghost instead of lit on fire by hell. You know, you get tongues of fire, Acts chapter 2, or tongues of hell. James chapter, what is it, 3? I'm going with heaven. Tongue amonia tana makshi tolum para. Ha ha, divrafane, set on fire of heaven. You're not my tongue's not going to be given over, and this my members are consecrated to God. My tongue's not going to be given over to the things that belong to slander, the things that belong to taking His name in vain. Amen. My dear friend Tyler got a revelation the other day of taking the name of the Lord Jesus in vain, where you're just speaking it and it's not even moving. You're not even moving in faith and don't even believe anything's going to happen with it. You just do it out of religion. Come on, that's true. Because the Holy Ghost will start paring the thing down and start making it sharper and start making it brighter so that you understand everything about interacting with God is sacred and holy. And all the things that you try to bring God into this secular and that just simply is human, you just profaned it. Huh? On one hand, you're blessing God. On the other hand, you're cursing man. He's not going to be anywhere around it. Holy Spirit's not involved in it. He's just like backing off. He says, you're on your own. I love you, and I'm here, but I'm not a part of that. Holy Spirit, Spirit truth, will not mess up, will not mix it up with any spirit of a lie. He won't. He will not mix it up with falsehood. He will not mix up with anything that is not the Word of God. He will be there reproving, rebuking, correcting, instructing, pleading, convincing, doing everything He can get us to do to shut up. Amen. And to change. But He will not participate with it. You will not have Him in that. He will not be in it. He will not be in it. He will not be in it. You want him to be in it? It's got to be what God is doing. The character of God, the nature of God, the ways of God. Love, blessings when cursed. Loving when hated. Persecuting, you know, blessing when persecuted. Praise the name of the Lord. It is just amazing that we have this. I have this. You have this. And he's done. He's the temple of the Holy Ghost. And somebody says, well, when I start talking in this way, does he vacate? Depends on how far you go with it. Because reality of it is, if he remains, he's going to convince you, he's going to correct you, and you're going to repent. And if you don't repent, he's going to vacate. There are many people who go to church and the Holy Ghost is not in them. He vacated and they do not know he departed. They are purely religious. They're bound by religion. All of the behavior, they can shout, they can run around. Some of them and go, la, 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 la. But God, the Holy Ghost isn't even there. He vacated. Why? Because they went in to a realm of sin. Unforgiveness could have been some other thing. A lot of times it's more subtle things. True. Some kind of envy, some kind of strife, some kind of lust of the flesh, some kind of lust of the eyes, some kind of pride of life. The Holy Ghost convicted them, convinced them, reproved them, rebuked them, sent prophets over and over again. They refused to repent. He vacated. He gave them a time and place to repent. And then they were taken over by a religious spirit. And it's a religious spirit speaking. It's true. Because once you learn discerning of spirits, you can see religious spirit. I can see religious spirits working on people. And we, because the Lord made us seers and gave us the ability to see. I mean, we don't get to see everything. We know in part, we speak in part. But there's certain things that God gave us to speak and to see because he's made us shepherds over his household. And we've got to have spiritual skill sets to be able to meet, to do what he's called us to do, because this is not in a natural world. It has nothing to do with really, I mean, yeah, the disposition of your face, your demeanor and your disposition does speak a lot, but we don't go off of that. If we go off of that, then that's hit and miss. That's really truly hit and miss. Because we don't know. You could be about to throw up. And you're here moving in faith. And you're about to throw up. You're breaking through some kind of sickness and disease. And you know, and your disposition, your demeanor looks horrible. And if we were going to go off of that, we're like, say, they're demon-possessed. Something happened, you know, spiritually, they completely. No, they're about to throw up, man. They're breaking through some kind. So we're not, God hasn't limited us to looking with the eyes, what we see with the eyes. He's given us a spirit of discerning. Spirits and know what's going on so that we can help you and say, look, you know, you're being harassed, tormented by this thing or that thing, the other thing. And then that's where your need to be in submission really comes in. Because if you're not in submission and authority and if you don't honor the anointing, then what is going to happen is you're not going to take it serious. And that thing's going to take you over. But if you really are in submission, and because this is where it all works and this is what it's all about, and you honor the anointing, you're going to immediately get arrested. I don't want that thing around me. Yeah. Let's pray right now. Run it off, Pastor. Yes. Get that Amen. Thing. Destroy it right now. Are you ready? Amen. And so the Holy Spirit, a large part of what the Holy Ghost does in leading us and guiding us is through the ministry that he has set up in the midst of the church. And that's just absolutely true. It's just true. It's absolutely. Choice of words. Absolute. He gave prophets. He gave apostles. He gave prophets. He gave pastors. He gave evangelists, he gave teachers for the perfecting of the saints, for the building up of the body of Christ. That's what he did. That's how he speaks. I mean, back in the Latter Rain Revival, everybody began to describe the fivefold ministry of apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, teacher as the hand ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ. But I'm just, and it fits, and I understand that, and that's great. But really, it is the mouthpiece ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ. It is understanding the leadership and the divine authority of God the Holy Ghost in the church. Understanding the leadership and the divine authority and the headship of Christ Jesus in the midst of the church. And how he appropriates that authority and that interaction through his apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. One amen. Praise God. Two amens. Two amens. Can I just shake your hand? Just thank you so much. I'm just so blessed that you came to the meeting tonight. Everybody else is in shockland. Do you not agree with it?
Amen.
Is that an amen that you don't agree with?
No.
Amen is to agree, to receive it in, to be established in the faith. That's what it means, amen. I mean, I have to wonder because, you know, I have to wonder because I know that this is one of Satan's primary targets to stop the move of God in people's life and to shut down growth and maturity in God's people's life. So if I'm standing here telling you something and everybody looks like they're in shock, two amens. One was weak and the other was almost silent. God, we have to recognize the leadership of the divine authority and the headship of the Holy Ghost in the midst of the church. We have to recognize the leadership of the divine authority and the headship of the Lord Jesus Christ in His church and the fact that He appropriates that authority through His apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers.
Amen.
Thank you. I was afraid. Maybe you didn't hear. You want to grab it. You want to grab it. Because Satan, if you don't recognize where Satan's attack is against your life, how are you ever going to effectively launch a defense? I'm not going to be defensive. I'm going to be constantly on the attack. If you've ever played chess with me, that's me. I don't care, win or lose. I'm on you. Boom, 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 boom. I'm on the offensive. I'm not playing no defense. Come on. God doesn't need a defense. He doesn't need a defender. He doesn't need us to defend ourselves. It's His department. He's good at it. Ooh, He's good at it. I feel sorry for all of my enemies. I feel sorry for all your enemies. I feel sorry for everyone who persecutes you. I feel sorry for everyone you have to feel like you need to give a defense against, because God is the defender and the upholder of all such people. He will avenge me speedily. Hallelujah. You too. Us. So we get to quickly to, maybe not so quickly, but I'm going to try to be quickly, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, and we begin to understand this just even that much better. Why were we born of the Spirit? What happens when we're born of the Spirit? We're born of the Spirit. We're given a new heart. We're given a new spirit. We're made a new creation. He comes and dwells in us. We are the temple of the Holy Ghost. He's with us and in us. Praise God to lead us and guide us into all truth. So in every way we can be conformed to the image of Christ, that we can learn to conduct ourselves as Father conducts Himself, that we can live in a manner that enjoys all the blessings and splendor of heaven, to live days of heaven upon the earth. This is what He's doing. Why is it such a big deal to have to leave death to come into life? Why is it such a big deal to say no to everything that Satan wants to do to destroy us, so that you and I could be built up in everything of this that belongs to this new creation by the Creator? I mean, come on. This good news. Coming out of darkness. Somebody said, do I get to still play soccer? Sure, kick the ball around until you're exhausted. You know what I'm saying? Huh? I can still go surfing. I dream about it. I said to my wife, I'm taking three surfboards and putting them over at the house just so that I can dream. Because what happens to you get older and all of a sudden the Word of God is more important than going surfing. Amen. Kicking the ball around, throwing the ball around, shouting about the football. Amen. Screaming for the pigskin. They probably don't even make it out of pigskin anymore. I don't know. All the synthetic material, maybe. Do they? Tradition. We're a funny lot. We are. Especially people from America. And it's just, you know, no one can understand our games. We do the World Series and don't invite any other nation. It's just on and on and on. Jesus. It's crazy. Let me get my Bible out. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Born again so we can be taught of God. Born again so that we can encounter the kingdom of God. Born again so that we can interact with the kingdom of God. Born again so we can participate with the kingdom of God. Born again so that we can have an understanding and a knowledge of the kingdom of God, which the Holy Spirit brings to us. The only way that we can have encounter with the kingdom of God is to be born of the Spirit. The only way that we can participate with the kingdom of God is to be born of the Spirit. The only way we can understand the kingdom of God is to be born of the Spirit. Now that we are born of the Spirit, we are a new creation. We've been washed with the water of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Spirit. Huh? He's not only given us a new heart and new spirit, He's put His Spirit in us. Why? So that we can be led, so that we can be taught, so that we can be instructed, so that we got the insight to be able to divide good from evil, light from darkness, so that we can begin in every way to enjoy all the pleasures forevermore that belongs to this realm. And so then, you know, Paul takes it up in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, and if you just look with me here in verse 6, and of course, leading up to verse 6, Paul's saying, we're going to minister to you in the realms by the Spirit of God. Why? We're going to come with a demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power so that your faith will be in God, not in men. Why? What is he saying? We want to introduce you to a supernatural heavenly realm. What God the Holy Spirit is going to do is he's going to function in the realms of that which is heavenly and supernatural. What he's going to do when he begins to move and when he's expressed through us, you will encounter the kingdom of God. You will be encountering that realm in which God dwells. As Jesus said in Matthew 12, 28, he said, if I cast out devils and work miracles among you by the Spirit, by the Holy Ghost, then the kingdom of God has come to you. So every activity of the Holy Spirit is revelation of the kingdom of God. Every interaction with the Holy Spirit is an interaction with the kingdom of God. He brings to us the kingdom of God. He reveals the King of the kingdom of God. Amen. The Holy Spirit reveals Jesus. Without the Holy Spirit, Amen. There's nothing about Jesus revealed. He's come to make him known. Amen. He's come to take all that belongs to the Father, which is all that belongs to, all that Jesus has belongs to the Father. All that the Father has, he's given to his Son, Christ Jesus. And he's come to make it known, to reveal it to us, to reveal who Jesus is and to reveal all that belongs to heirship and co-inheritance with him. Amen. Are we willing to learn?
Yes.
No, I'm too busy with whatever. This thing or that thing or the other thing, it's captivated me. Spend time fasting and praying, and you will learn what it means to be captivated by his presence.
Amen.
Then, when you begin to be captivated by other things, the contrast will become that much plainer. You need the contrast. Because as long as there's a mixture, you don't have a dividing line. You can't see clearly. It's all hybridized. It's all commingled. Separate the thing, separate out the two so that you have a clear distinction between hot and cold, light and darkness, good and evil. So you know when you cross the line. You know, it's like I was saying last year, one of the words that the Lord gave me for last year is draw a bloodline of Jesus Christ in that place of separation unto God, belonging to God, and don't step over the line. Understand what it means to step over that line. Because if you'll do that, Satan cannot come to you. He cannot cross the line. He cannot cross the line to you in a place separated to God. He cannot touch you. He cannot access you. You have to cross over the bloodline back into adjoining and agreeing with the things of the world for Satan to be able to touch you. That's why I always say, many times say, not always, but in 1 John 5:18, we know that everyone who is begotten of God, born of God, born of the Spirit, once again, I'll go ahead and add things in there because they're synonyms, made synonyms by the Scripture. We know that everyone who is born of God, who is born again, who has become spirit, does not sin. He keeps himself and the wicked one cannot touch him. Why? He's drawn a bloodline. The bloodline of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
That separates him or her from all that is in the world. It separates them into a place called the heavenly, belonging to the kingdom of God, the family of God. In this oneness and agreement with the Spirit of God in Christ Jesus. Do you know that what I am saying right now, the majority of the Christian church in the United States of America will not listen to for 5 minutes? Do you understand this? Yes. I mean, I just praise God for you guys, because you've been listening to clearly for more than 5 minutes. Good place to say amen. And you know, I'll tell you something else, something that's so beautiful to me, is that bottom line of it is, if I call for a prayer meeting, I'm going to have just as many people at the prayer meeting as come to the regular meeting. Which then equates into the fact that we have the biggest church in one of the biggest churches in America. Which equates into the fact that we have one of the biggest churches in America.
Amen.
It's true. I would hate to pastor a church of 10,000 people and only 100 people came to the prayer meeting. I would hate that, because what would happen is the spirit of the 10,000 people would dominate the atmosphere of that place, and I would not be happy. No. I would be throwing chairs across the room. I'd throw a chair through the window and jump out behind it. Howbeit we speak wisdom among them that are perfect. Amen. Hallelujah. Only a few people in the earth today even understand that verse of scripture. Yet not the wisdom of this world, nor the princes of this world, that come to nothing. But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world into our glory, which none of the princes of this world knew, for had they known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. They were completely cut off, separated from what is going on in the realms of the Spirit, of what God is saying, of what God is doing. They had no revelation of the kingdom of God, no revelation of the person of God, no revelation of movings of God. Nicodemus is an exception. He's at least willing to recognize, wait a minute, no man can do these works unless God is with him. Immediately he's inquiring about the kingdom of God. We know, obviously, that he went with that. We know that he moved forward that because he was taking care of the body of Jesus. To what degree Nicodemus, we don't know, because we'll have to wait and see later, because he's not mentioned again, not by that name anyways. This is what we've been born in the Spirit. Because it is written, eye has not seen. And let me just say this, because I'm going to distill this for you. Because I can't see it. The sense realm cannot get it. The sense realm taught by men, governed by the realms and the laws and the nature of that which was produced from the human being. Now, what is convoluted into the human being? Into that which is born of the flesh, that which is born of a man and a woman. This is a nature true. Absolutely, you cannot parse that out, because all are born in sin and shaped in iniquity, because the sin of Adam has passed upon all men, and all have sinned. The things that Paul revealed in Romans chapter 5. So you can't parse those out. But the bottom line of it is, the Lord is telling us, in the state that men are in, until they have an encounter with the living God, Christ Jesus, and a miracle of the new birth comes, they are not able to see. Eye has not seen, ear has not heard, neither has it entered in the heart of man the things which God has prepared for them that love him. Amen. Obedience is in there big time. Yes. Yes. But God hath revealed them unto us by his Spirit, for the Spirit searches all things, yea, the deep things of God. So here we are. Everything that God is, everything that God has, everything that God is doing, everything that God wants for our life is the only possible way for you and I to ever be able to understand it, ever be able to get it, is that we have to be able to come into an agreement with the Holy Spirit so that we can hear from him, so that we can be taught by him, so that we can agree with him. That's the new birth. That's why no man can encounter the kingdom of God until he's born again, or he participate with the kingdom of God until he's born again. Now that we are, what are we going to do? Are we going to give all diligence to making our call and election? Are we going to value it? Is it going to be that? Is it going to be? Is it going to be a level of importance to us that we've laid a hold of the true riches? So Paul goes on to say, but God has revealed them to us by His Spirit. Verse 11, for what man knows the things of a man save the spirit of man that is in him? Even so, the things of God knoweth no man but the Spirit of God. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit which is of God, that we may know all things that we might know the things that are freely given to us of God. And understand, once again, the Holy Spirit is speaking to us by the realms that He exists in, which is the Spirit. God is a Spirit. They that worship God must worship Him in spirit. Those that are going to interact with God are going to interact with Him in spirit. Now he makes the contrast even a little bit more clear. Which things also, verse 13, we speak in the words which, okay, verse 14, forgive me. But the natural man, that man which is born of the flesh, that which is the flesh is flesh. That which is a purely human being, born of a man, born of a woman, mama and a father, not born of a man. All right, praise God. Born of a man, male and female, okay? But the natural man receives not the things of the Spirit of God. They're foolishness in him. Neither can they be known, because they are spiritually discerned. But he that is spiritual judges all things, yet he himself judges no man. For who hath known the mind of the Lord, that he may instruct him? But we have received the mind of Christ. The mind of Christ, the mind of the Spirit, the disposition and thinking that is brought to us by the Holy Ghost, that we can look at evil and see the death and the sting of death in it, the destruction, the tyranny of Satan being leveled against us, so that the things that Satan would use to deceive us is perfectly exposed. While we're living over here in a realm taught by the Holy Ghost, receiving everything that belongs to the Father, receiving everything that belongs to the Lord Jesus Christ, which is impossible to be able to grab a hold of, understand, participate with, or encounter in any way in the realms of the human existence. Amen. So, when you hear preachers talk to you about, oh, this is the issues concerning our human condition, they're lying to you. Oh, we are in the human condition. These are the problems because of our human condition. These are the things that we're confronting because of our human condition. And it's going on in the highest levels, as it were, of that which is acceptable to men. Credentials are given to preachers based upon popular opinion. Did you know that most songs that are written by all these musicians across the world, they are rated and ranked up on whether or not it's a good song by people who are 13 to 14 years of age? Did you know that? The 13-year-olds decide what's your best and most favorite song. Hello. I say that to make a point. Men, in a popular framework of things, decide, based upon the majority in the United States of America and the disposition of the spiritual state and nature of that majority, decide who are the most credible preachers. I would rather go with the 13-year-olds. I believe I'm going to go with the 13-year-olds. Because I'm emphasizing something there. If the spiritual situation and condition of the United States of America was boiling over with the glory of God and a fervency for the things of the Spirit and a wonderful working power of God, the Holy Ghost in life, then let the majority prevail. But if that is not the case, if really the spiritual climate is rather lukewarmness and apathy and lethargy and spiritual defilement, then why would I want to listen to the credentials and the voice of that which the spirit, the majority, the spiritual majority, elevates? Father wants us to listen to Him, Amen. To His Word, Amen. The faithful stewards of His Word. Amen. Now people are going to give you popular opinion. Now people are going to rewrite the Bible for you and try to convince you that they're declaring to you the infallible, inerrant, plenary of the Word of God. And this is, and we, each one of us, are responsible never before, and to know what God's Word says and to listen carefully. Because and there's certainly something that the Father is doing. It doesn't take a genius or someone with great insight to recognize that God, Father is developing something that is enormous and amazing. In the sense that He has now made His Word available to everybody.
Yes.
Over these past 500 years. I want you to get ready, people.
Amen.
I want you to get ready. I want you to get ready. I mean, I really believe the Lord has shown me some things that I've only shared with my wife. That some things that are just... It's just dramatic of things that I'm seeing happen, and what I believe that the Lord is showing me about the future. That, you know, this I'm not going to talk about it and preach on it because it's not clear in the Word of God. It's indicated only. I'm not going to preach to you on those things that are indicated that I believe the Lord has shown me. I'm going to keep those, and I'm going to move and plan accordingly as God has shown me and given me that insight. For the purpose of what He wants me to do. What I'm going to preach to you is those things which are most certainly the Word of God.
Amen.
Which is most certainly provable by anybody who's willing to open up the Bible and honestly look at the Word of God and not edit His Word.
Amen.
People, bottom line of it is, listen to me. It's time that each person in this place on a whole nother level of consecration and commitment. Recognize, you've been born in the Spirit. Are you living by the Spirit? Do you understand? And don't just be quick on that. Just say, wait a minute. Yes, but I want to be certain. Yes, but there are things that need to be adjusted and refined. And as some people say, tweaked in my life. But in some situations, it's far more than just a tweak. It's walking in another direction. It's another attitude. Because unless we're willing to be consecrated to that which we've been brought into, the riches of His glory that we've been given, we're never going to see what I can't see. Because we're not agreeing with Him and being led by Him and listening to Him and being in that state, in that place where He can speak to us. He radically changed us so He can speak to us. If the radical change isn't something we're not willing to, if the radical change is something that we're unwilling to be consecrated to, then we're not going to be able to receive what the radical change was supposed to give to us. We're not going to have the discerning heart to understand,
Amen.
The listening ears to hear,
Amen.
The spiritual eyes to see. He's going to talk. He's going to be wanting to lead us. He's going to be wanting to guide us. He's going to want to be strengthen us. He's going to want to empower us. He's going to want to teach us how to be spiritual, to walk after the Spirit. He's going to want to teach us how to desire earnestly the spiritual, to be passionate about the spiritual. Literally, the word zelotes, zelos, Greek word, even its Hebrew equivalence, means jealous. Jealous. I'm so jealous for God. I'm so jealous for the things of the Spirit and for the spiritual. I'm so covetous. It means all of those things. Zealous, desirous, warlike spirit. Passionate. So we're not going to grow. We're not going to develop. We're not going to mature. We're not going to walk in the giftings and the skill set that God the Holy Spirit wants to establish us in. Look at the threshold of that skill set. All that the Father has. Whoa. Ha. It just takes my breath away thinking about it. All that the Father has, all that belongs to Him, all that I have, all that the Father has, He's given unto me. Therefore said I, you shall take of mine and shall show it unto you. Reveal it. Transmit it. Disclose it. So that you can see it. So that you can hear it. So that you can understand it. So that you can function in the same knowledge that I have, the same thinking that I have, the mind of Christ, the mind of the Spirit. The natural man can't receive it. If you're going to act like a natural man, live like a natural man, soak yourself in that which belongs to a worldly, secular realm. People, once again, there is very little difference between you and the person that is born of the flesh that Jesus was addressing in John chapter 3. I don't care how saved you believe you are, you're not living like you saved. I don't care how born again you believe you are, you're not living like you're born again. I don't care how changed by the Spirit of God and made spirit you believe you are, you're not living as one in the Spirit, born of the Spirit. Thus, you have eliminated your the whole gifting and glory and riches for which Christ died and rose again and went into heaven so that we could be in this place to be taught of God. Yes. They all should be taught of God. Yes. All, that's the promise. They all should be taught of God. God's going to rebuild His temple in our hearts. Jeremiah. What do you want God to do with your life? Where do you want Him to take you? You know, there's nothing like living out the life of Jesus. And I'm gonna tell you my secret. My secret is this. I desperately want God to make me a prophet. I desperately want God. That's my passion. That's what I want more than anything else. But a prophet like Jesus, not a prophet like Elijah, not a prophet like Jeremiah, a prophet like Jesus. Though he said John was the greatest prophet, clearly, he's the greatest prophet. Where do you want? What do you want? What are you covetous for? What are you zealous for? Are the spiritual? Do you have goals there? There are skill sets you want to develop? Are the things in the Word of God cause you just with excitement and passion? I want to be that. When I was a little guy, I decided what position I wanted to play. I wanted to play second base because I like the action there. I'm a little guy, right? Little baseball cap, bat, glove, right? And I want to be the backup pitcher. So I just gave myself to it, man. I gave myself, and I was that. And some of you can relate to the same thing. You had your little guy, you saw something, you said, I want to be that, and you went after it. You said, I'm going to do that. Some of you surfers, whatever. You know, whatever, wherever you were, different things in life, different times of life, it changed and it developed. But how about in the kingdom of God? What do you want? What is it that you're jealous for? I want to do that. Because if you don't have that going on inside of you, you've been deprived of something that God has purposed for you to have. Somehow the fire's been put out. Somehow you've been distracted. Your heavenly vision has been somehow distorted or snatched away from you to some measure. Get it back. You need to be jealous and covetous of that which is the spiritual. Being spirit beings. We are spirit. We are spirit. We're more than just spirit beings. We're spirit on the level that God is spirit. That's what He made us. Yes. We're not human beings in the human condition. We've been removed from that. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, or that which is born of the spirit is spirit. And then Paul emphasizes it in Romans 8 and 9. He says, you were in the flesh, but now you are in the spirit. He takes the born-again experience and begins to amplify it in very unique and radical ways in Romans chapter 8. What do you want? What are you craving? What are you passionate for? What are you zealous for? What are you jealous for? What are you determined to have? What are you aching about? What is your cry out to God for? I mean, one of those things within that framework is, you know, Ann and I are both together in this. I cannot bear to have some Christian tell me that they're going to go get surgery. Or they succumb to some sickness or succumb to some disease. It just enrages me. And I got to hold it back. It enrages me that that's where they're going to retreat to. It just aggravates me, when it overwhelms me to a point of desperation, when I see someone who's crippled and sick and diseased, because I got to get them healed. Because that's what God demands. Because that's what Jesus does. That's His ministry. And I'm not willing to write that off or change that. Are you? Are you? Because I'm talking about living in the Spirit and walking in the Spirit. And Jesus is the model of it. What does it mean to live in the Spirit? And how to think properly and how to reason properly and perceive properly. Because that's all encompassed in we have the mind of Christ. And what is our judgments about what we encounter around us? Are they God's judgments? Are we willing to leave the blind man blind, the deaf person deaf, the crippled person crippled, the diseased person diseased? Are we willing to succumb to the pressures of going elsewhere and retreating back to some other remedy and solution for our needs? There's got to be a radical change. There's got to be a radical change. You're born of the Spirit. You're going to learn how to be. You're going to have to learn to be Spirit. You have to learn how to be the spirit beings that you are, not the human beings that you've been. Not the human beings that you're pressured in the society to be. That everybody's aggravated and upset. If you don't act like them, they're going to persecute you, because the fact of it is you're a light. You make them very uncomfortable because you're not going along with what it is that they believe you're supposed to do. Who do you think you are? Who do I think I am? I'm born of the Spirit. To live in the Spirit. To walk in the Spirit. To act like God. To act like Jesus. To reason like God. To think like God. Not to think like a natural man. Not to think like a human being. Not to think like a man of the flesh. But to think and perceive things the way that God thinks of them and perceives them. Amen. And there's Jesus. He's saying, how have you still hardened your heart? Can't you let the miracles and the signs and the wonders and the things that I've revealed to you concerning the kingdom of God be that which you now use as the precedence for the expectation of what's going to happen next? Can't you remember the 7 loaves and the 2 fishes and the 12 basketfuls and the 5,000 plus, not counting women and children, that were fed? Don't you realize you're in another realm? Don't you realize you're in the realms of heaven? Don't you realize you're in the realms of the Spirit? Don't you realize you're in the realm of the kingdom of God? How long are you going to continue to think like men? How long do I have to put up with the adulterous and perverse generation? Hear it? Hear it? Hear it? Do you hear it? When are you going to be of the Spirit? When are you going to be of heaven? When are you going to be of the kingdom? When are you going to be kingdom-minded? When are you going to think with the mind of Christ, the mind of the Spirit? When are you going to stop thinking and reasoning like men? Hear it. Now. That's right. Now. That's right. That's the right response. You can't sit in silence. You have to respond. Hear it. That's spiritual leadership. You don't designate spiritual leadership and qualify it based upon human preferences. It is revealed by the reaction. My Father revealed that to you. Flesh and blood has not revealed that to you, Peter. My Father, you in the realm of the Spirit, you've encountered, you're able to participate with, you're able to see and understand. You're not sitting in silence. Everybody else is going, like us. Peter goes, you're the Son of the living God. That's who you are. Come on now. You hear that. You hear that leadership now. Hear that leadership now. And when you hear leadership speaking out of the realms of the Spirit, imitate them. Don't act like you the original. I said, don't act like you the original. I mean, that's one of the pride of life of Southern California. Everybody thinks they are original. You're not original. His imitation is, you know, come on. Vanilla. Christ Jesus is the original. Amen. And those who are conformed to Him. Amen. That's pressing in. Amen. For the original. Amen. You got to find people who know about the Spirit, who are hungry for the Spirit, and follow them and act like them. Why? Because they have unveiled something of the Spirit. You should immediately want to grab onto it. Not because you're like, but if you're competitive and you've got that thing going on in the pride of life, you're going to draw back. You're not going to accept them. They're not approved by you. Hey, it's not about being approved by you. Is it approved by God? Amen. Is it a manifestation of the Spirit, of the kingdom of God, of God, what God is doing? Yes. Then do it with them.
Amen.
Because it's revelation from Him.
Amen.
Amen. We need to recognize the headship and leadership, the Godship, the authority of the Holy Spirit
Amen.
In the church and in our line. We need to recognize the headship, the leadership, the Godship, the authority of Jesus Christ in the church. And recognize that He manifests that authority primarily through His apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers.
Amen.
That was a little weaker amen than the last amen, but that's okay. At least everybody said amen. I'm a choir director. My expectation's different. I heard one man of God say, you know, if the choir director only had 10% of the choir show up for choir practice, he'd say, listen, I'm done with this. You guys aren't serious. But if the pastor called for everybody to come to prayer and 10% of people showed up, he would die of complete shock. See the expectation? Dysfunction? See the expectation dysfunction?
Yeah.
It should be equivalent to the choir director.
Yeah.
Only 10% of people showed up. Not die of shock. But I'm done with this thing, man. You guys aren't serious. I'm done with this. Get serious.
Amen.
Get serious or get another pastor. You know that many of the churches, if not the majority of the churches, will not allow the pastor to be who God has made him to be. It is governed by the board. It's governed by the board. The presbyteros that already exist within the church. I've always tried to picture myself going into this context. I think I'd be the hired and fired as quick as you know what I'm saying. Praise God that isn't here.
Praise
it
God.
Isn't it doesn't exist in His churches where the Spirit of the Lord is allowed to move.
Amen.
Do you know how many people will leave this church and leave this meeting over the years, have left this church and left this meeting to go into that bondage, and they don't know the difference? Many they don't even know the difference. They've never known the difference. They never knew the difference from that which belonged to the human existence and that which belonged to the Spirit. They never knew. We pled, we begged, we pleaded, we cried out, we reproved, we corrected, we rebuked, but it never was received. And the more they heard the rebuke and the reproof, the harder they made their hearts. And the more they resisted God. Paul said it. As soon as they resisted him, well said Isaiah the prophet concerning your fathers. You do always resist the Holy Ghost. It was Paul that they were resisting. As far as they were concerned. And from the dynamics of human interaction. But from the realms of the Spirit, they resisted God. They resisted God, the Holy Ghost. Understand, people, God wants you to see, hear, and understand in the realms of the kingdom, the realms of the Spirit. You have to give yourself over to it. You have to divorce yourself and cut yourself off from everything that you've learned in the human perception and the human dynamics and the human thinking. It's time, people. It's time. As Ruth Ann responded by the Spirit, it's now. It's time. You think wrong. You live wrong. You act wrong. You start thinking right. You'll live right. You'll act right. God, the Holy Spirit's the one who brings that to us. Amen. Everybody stand with me. Hallelujah. Give a shout to the Lord. I must tell you that wasn't very much of the Spirit, but that's okay. At least you shouted to the Lord. You keep doing that, it becomes, sometimes I'll let you know, I'll just tell you. I'll tell you, well, that's heavenly, or I'll just tell you that's earthly. That was Rollerama. That's okay. You were obedient, you were responding, because you just keep shouting, and it'll break out into a Holy Ghost shout. It will. It will. It will. It will. Well, and you gotta learn how to take correction and as instruction, as coaching. I'm here to coach you in the Holy Ghost. I'm here to help you discern. Okay, you know I'm gonna reach in for an anointing and stay in an anointing. I'm gonna reach in for the realms of cooperating with the Holy Ghost and stay in that realm. Huh? Hallelujah. And somewhere you're gonna find that it's gonna correct your prayer life, where you just don't just pray just out of the realms of your own thinking or out of the realms of your own state. And especially if you've been offline and you've been just crowded down with a bunch of people around you who don't know the Lord, hunkered over some work project. You know, you need to go pray in the Holy Ghost a bit. Huh? Somebody said, why don't you lead us in prayer? I would just start off, and let it come. You know, too many times people pray and as a way of talking to people. I had somebody pray for me today. Oh, I'm going to pray over the phone. And I said, sure, go right on ahead. And they prayed. And really, their prayer was just talking to me. And it's like, come on, you know, but towards the end, I started feeling a little bit of the anointing. Started feeling a little bit like they turned their heart towards God. And then they ended the prayer right. And Father, we ask this in Jesus' name. And I said, amen. In Jesus' name. Because now I got a hold of some truth here, okay? Praise God. Come on, listen. Let's just be spirit. Let's just be in spirit. Let's be of the spirit. Say, let's be of the spirit. Say, I'm going to be of the spirit.
I'm going to be of the spirit.
And that's not hard to do. It's just saying, Holy Spirit, lead me. Holy Spirit, I want to hear you. Holy Spirit, I give myself to you. I want to live by you. I'm going to do what you say. I'm going to give myself to love. I'm going to give myself to humility. I'm going to give myself to brokenness. And as you do it, just walk this out. I'm going to give myself to excellence of character, to purity, to holiness, to righteousness. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You are the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, who was and is to come. You are the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, who was and is to come. You are the mighty God, the great I am.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah. Tonight, if there's been any things in your life that you feel has caused you misdirection, distraction, hindrances, let it be broken off. Tonight, if there's any place in your life where you can recognize that you have wrong responses to the Word of God going forth, you have wrong responses to instruction, you have wrong responses to relationship in your life, let that thing be broken off. Let it be destroyed. Let the simple relationship that is provided for us in Christ Jesus make the difference. Take a hold of the blood of Jesus Christ right now. Take a hold of the blood. apply the blood of Jesus Christ. Faith in the blood of Jesus Christ is going to make all the difference to anything that Satan would try to impose upon you. And the Lord's going to say, he's going to say, listen, you can ask whatever you want, and if you just believe that you received it, it's going to be yours. But when you're standing there asking whatever you want, you better recognize that if you have anyone that you need to forgive, you've got to take care of that. You've got to take care of it. If you carry around the spirit of offense, people, I'm going to tell you right now, believe me, it is one of the biggest bondages that exist that Satan uses against God's people to keep them from moving forward in the realms of the spirit. They're held in a prison. They're held in a prison of offense. Some people, I've known some people, it was because of something their mother did. I've known some people, something their father did. I've known some people, something that their brother did, something that their sister did, something that a very close and dear friend did. Some broken relationship. And we just simply take the blood of Jesus Christ and say, no more. I'm going to live free from that. You cannot deal with it. You think you can deal with it? You think counseling is going to resolve it? You think that somehow, psychologically, some kind of mental agreement is going to deal with it? Some talking about it? Let's all get together and talk about it. And that's going to make a difference? And sit down and talk to God about all your sins. He don't remember them. He don't bring them up. We're not talking about something that's in the past. We're talking about something that people are hanging on to right now. Traits, dispositions, activities, things that you've compromised with. I want you to renounce them right now in Jesus' name. Because only the blood of Jesus Christ can work the miracle of dissolving that thing. And it's a miracle. And it's a miracle by confession where you say, Lord, I have done wrong. And what happens is when you live in an offense or you live in unforgiveness or you live in some of these other things, what happens is it causes you to violate more in the spirit than you were ever violated by whatever offended you. Because whatever holds you prisoner continues to reproduce through your life that same offense against others and primarily against God. Same unforgiveness, same whatever. Discouragement, depression, I break the power of it, says the Lord. But you have to apply it. The blood of Jesus Christ was shed not only for our sins, but the sins of the whole world. But the whole world is not a beneficiary of it because they never applied it. They never agreed with God. They never allowed it to be broken. There are people standing here tonight that you've never come to the Lord and said, Lord, is it I? Is it me? Everybody in that place, including Judas, said one by one, Lord, is it I? Think about that. When the Lord was saying, one of you here tonight, you're going to betray me. One of you tonight, you're held in this place of bondage. Everyone, including Judas, said, Lord, is it I? It was only to Judas that he said, you said so. Because the Lord wasn't going to have a false interaction with anyone. I want you to ask yourself tonight, how transparent are you with God? How transparent are you with your leadership around you? How submitted are you to God? How submitted are you to your leadership around you? Because I'm going to tell you right now, these things right here, just what I'm talking about right now, will make the difference of whether you're going to walk in the Spirit or you're going to walk as a mere human being. And believe you me, be ultimately possibly a victim of a religious spirit where the Holy Ghost is displaced altogether. I say to everybody in this place, there is no reason for anyone to even run the rare chance of it possibly happening to you. Not when God's call and God's grace and God's mercy is so prevalent. But you're going to have to get transparent. You're going to have to say, Lord, is it I? Lord, is it me? Lord, show me the things that you want changed in my life. I want to change. Show me the directions. Lord, show me things that I've got going on that you don't want in my life.
Yeah.
Don't make them up. You don't have to start giving God suggestions. Do you hear what I'm saying? Let it speak to you. Hallelujah. I used to know guys that they go surfing, you know, 6 to 8 hours a day, and they thought that this surfing was really the problem. They're just addicted to surfing. They surf so much, and surfing's the problem. No, surfing wasn't the problem. You know what your problem was? The person's problem, and I know so many people in this situation, what the problem was? Condemnation. Spirit of condemnation. Discouragement. They always just lived in condemnation and discouragement. Spirit. And they would address it, but they couldn't hear it. Because I tell you right now, look, there's a big difference between you just submit yourself to God, just say, Lord, I love you, just show me. And then just respond to him in this love. And don't get off in the place of just wondering, scratching your head, feeling like, oh, he's talking about me. Listen, if you said tonight, he's talking about me, you were right, you are absolutely right, and we need to break that demonic power off of you. Because that thing is birthed out of offense, and it is the spirit of the devil harassing you. And I guarantee you, it's going to manifest in more way than one. So then I made it clear for you, didn't I? Yeah. So you don't have to be guessing, giving God a less, and trying to place your rage with the Holy Ghost. Because God don't talk to you like that. He talks to you when you just loving on, thanking him for his goodness. Oh, you're so good to me. You're so good to me. You're so good to me. So good to me. Don't let condemnation rule your life. Don't let offense and shame rule your life. Usually people are caught in condemnation because they're in prison to an offense. There's always a connection. Why is it, some people say, why does this happen to some people more than others? Why are some people more depressed than others? And there's always some connectivity to a place that you've not really been willing to release to the Lord. Because God, the Holy Ghost, has purpose to come and invade our lives. And I've spent a bit of time tonight, going a little bit longer tonight. I want to grab some things in your life. I want these 21 days in the first of this year to result in you being able to properly represent God in 2017. Come on. Listen. Properly represent God and properly speak on his behalf. You know, I'm going to be an example. You know, I'll just give you an example. At the Mission Training Center, there were some things we just had to do. We had to do because there was so much going on, so many things to do, we couldn't get it all done. And some of it was just bad. It was just far from the spirit of excellence. And I said, well, what we'll do is we'll just go into debt and we'll put a bunch of money into the place and we'll fix it up because we're going to set a model of the spirit of excellence. Because if we don't do it, if we don't show people how to do it, we can't expect them to do it. We can't expect them to understand how to move into it. We can sit around and wait and say, can anybody see the need here? And then step up to do it. You can't do it, and God doesn't do it that way. He goes out before us, and he leads us. And that's what we want to do for you. We want to go out before you, and we want to lead you in these things. I promise you, we don't have offense. I promise you, we don't have any unforgiveness in our life. I promise you that, you know, let me just tell you one thing that the Lord showed me a number of years ago. When you don't have unforgiveness in your life, you're praying, oh, Lord, restore that relationship that was taken. By whatever reason, you don't even have to know. Lord, restore it. Not, Lord, I forgive him, keep him away from me. Lord, I forgive him, I don't want to ever see him again. Yes. Don't be a prisoner because, you know, John said this. He said, they who hear us hear God. They that do not hear us do not hear God. Do you hear what he's saying? Yes. That authority is displayed through his apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. Do you hear it? Do you hear me? Do you hear me? Don't let anything rob you of this treasure. I didn't let anything rob you of it. I had a man and a woman stand out to me right now. They came to the meeting and she said to me, she said something like this. She said, the word of God is so rich here. And I have many friends who've been displaced from a church that need to come to this place. But none of us can handle you hollering. I said, why? And I'm going to tell you, they didn't know why. She didn't know why. I can tell you why. Spirit of offense against men. A dad. A brother. Another preacher. Somebody did them wrong. Spirit of offense. The word of God is rich, but we can't handle the way you deliver it. Spirit of offense. Demonic power keeping them from ever moving forward with God. And their choice. Your choice. You can decide to go into 2017 and live the way you've been living with the mixture, not pure, a mixture. Or you can say, no. I belong to the Spirit. I'm consecrated. Because listen, this is what consecration means. This is what sanctification means. This is what being one means. Living Him means I'm giving myself over to You, Lord, just to be with You, just to do Your way, just to commune, fellowship with You. Hallelujah. Everybody in this place, those of you watching online, lift your hands towards heaven. Just your hands towards heaven. Does the Spirit of the Lord touch you right now? I know God the Holy Ghost is pleading with several people in this place tonight. And He's made it so easy. He's not made it hard. I'm going to tell you right now, it'll definitely bust the spirit of pride right in the head. You'll definitely have to humble yourself. You'll definitely have to repent. You'll definitely have to seek forgiveness from a number of different people in some cases. But it will break every yoke and keep you from being held back and cause you to enter into a realm so glorious you can't even imagine. Hallelujah, how wonderful that is. So tonight, just decide. I don't see that there's anybody in this place who doesn't know the Lord Jesus Christ, but talking to those that are on the web right now or by YouTube, I want you to know right now, Christ Jesus stands right at the door of your heart, knocking right now. He said that to the church, and there are many backsliders that are watching me, that are listening to me right now. There are many people, you compromised until you found yourself fully backslidden, and no way, you can't see any way to get back, because repentance is too hard for you. There's too much forgiveness that you're going to seem to have to ask. It seems like to be blockaded before you. I release you from that thing right now in the name of Jesus Christ. I tell you, God loves you. It doesn't matter what's going on with man. Just turn your heart to Jesus. It's going to be easy for you to ask forgiveness once He comes and invades your life with all of His love. When you get captivated by love, it's going to take you where your hate can't allow you to go. It's going to take you where your discouragement, disappointment will not allow you to go. Just call on His name right now. I'm telling you, He's God in heaven. I'm promising you right now, He's God on the throne who loves you, who's committed to you. All you got to do is call upon Him. He stands ready to answer. I don't believe there's anything that more highlights the verses of Scripture calling to me and I will answer than God standing ready to do the most important miracle for everybody, and that's salvation. It isn't the other physical things and ailments and financial things and issues that you're dealing with in a material world. It's something far bigger that He stands ready to answer instantaneously. That is a cry for salvation, for a cry for restoration, a cry for forgiveness, a cry for the new creation. Maybe you've heard about God, you've heard about Jesus, you've heard about the church, but you've never had an encounter with God. He wants you to have one with Him. I promise you, if you'll cry out right now under the sound of my voice, if you say, God, if you're there, come to me right now. Touch me right now. I tell you, under the sound of my voice, as I'm speaking to you right now, God will come and He will invade your life. All you have to be is sincere in your heart. All you got to be is real with God, and He'll be real with you. I mean, He'll be so real that you'll know He's there. It's time for everybody to turn their hearts completely over to God. It's time for you to turn your life over to Him. It's time. Now's the time you start walking in the Spirit, living by the Spirit. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Ha ha. Hallelujah. Ha. Ha. Well, if anyone wants prayer for anything, you know we're always here to pray with you and for you. We know that God hears our prayers, that He will answer us. We touch the thing, whatever your need is, and we'll see a miracle take place. Doesn't matter how many times you've been prayed for, whether you've never been prayed for at all, we come together and know that Father is going to do it upon our request tonight, right now. Also, we want to give you an opportunity to worship the Lord with your giving. Father is supplying something miraculous to us with every act of obedience. He's there giving to us the multiplication of the miracles that He's promised, the multiplication of those things that, you know, we give over to Him, our life, our finances, everything about our life. He takes what little we give Him and He multiplies it. And I don't want you to miss out on one miracle that God wants to do for you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen.